was a little girl, I had a breakup. Only doll I never owned. Now I love you just the way I love that breakup. But only now my love has grown. And it gets
All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the 27th annual Seabury Quinn Jr. Playwrights Festival here at Ohio University. Yeah, I'm John Hendel. I'm one of the MFA playwrights, and I'm the festival producer this year.
Hi, I'm Mary Beekler. I'm the director of the School of Theater and an OU MFA playwriting grad.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us for this festival. It's a three-day developmental festival with all of our MFA, our seven MFA writers. So we have seven shows for you over 3 days, each one followed by a feedback session with three professional mentors from the professional theater world, because this is a virtual festival this year. Instead of the three usual mentors we have nine total mentors. And Mary, we should probably introduce the mentors, I think.
Woo! All right. We are super excited to welcome Martine Key Green Rogers, who is the newly named interim dean of the Division of Liberal Arts at the University of North Carolina School of the Arts. She's also an associate professor of SUNY New Paltz and the past president of the Literary Managers and Dramaturgs of the Americas, and the fellowship associate at the Playwrights Festival. Martine is going to be here for the entire festival responding to all seven plays. Shall I read everybody?
I'll do the next one. Let's just go back.
Go for it.
The other mentor is kind of in alphabetical order. We've got another OU alumnus, Aaron Carter. Aaron Carter is a playwright. He's an arts administrator and a television writer who has worked with Steppenwolf Theater Company. He's worked with CBS, currently working with Netflix. And like I said, he's a graduate of the OU MFA playwriting program, and he'll respond to Behead by Me. He'll respond to Aaron Elise McVeigh's play, Ivan Mosley, and Sky Robinson Hillis's play.
We've also got Julie Felice Dubiner. She is a dramaturg, consultant, and producer who has been artistic director of the American Revolutions at Oregon Shakespeare Festival and the resident dramaturg at Actors Theater of Louisville and Prince Music Theater. She is going to respond to Wendy Marie Martin's play, Aaron Elise McVeigh's play, and Sky Robinson Hillis's play.
We have Heather Holinsky, a Philadelphia-based freelance dramaturg and the current literary manager for Playwrights Foundation/the Bay Area Playwrights Festival. And she is the contest dramaturg for the 10th Annual Jewish Plays Project. And Heather will respond to Wendy Marie Martin's play.
Next, we have Laura Jacqmin. Laura is a Los Angeles-based playwright, TV writer, and games writer whose work has been seen at Steppenwolf, Long Wharf, Actors Theater of Louisville, and whose feature film, We Broke Up, woo, opens on video on demand tomorrow. She is a graduate of the OU MFA Playwriting Program, a founding member of the Kilroys, and she is going to respond today to Stephen's play.
And we also have Jacqueline Ryan. Oh, am I muted? I'm not. We also have Jacqueline Reingold. We're going to do that all weekend. Jacqueline Reingold's a playwright, television writer, and teacher whose work has been seen at Ensemble Studio Theater, MCC Theater, and Actors Theater of Louisville. Jackie is also a graduate of the OU MFA Playwriting Program, and she will respond to Clay Bainter's play.
We also have Stacey Rose. Stacey is a Charlotte-based playwright and TV writer who has had residencies and fellowships with organizations such as the Dramatists Guild, Playwrights Center, Sundance Theater Lab, and the Goodman. And she is going to respond to Ivan Mosley's play.
We have Crystal Skillman, a four-time New York Times critic pick playwright, podcast writer, and a current core member at the Playwrights Center. And Crystal will respond to my play.
And last but certainly not least, we have Tammy Winters, who is the Associate Artistic Director of No Theater of Cincinnati, where she has directed 12 main stage productions, including world and regional premieres by Kara Lee Corthran, Adam Simkowitz, Lauren Gunderson, and more. She is a graduate of the OU BFA program and Honors Tutorial College. Tammy will respond to Stephen's play today and also to Clay Bainter's play tomorrow.
In addition, you know, we have some people we would like to thank just who have helped us throughout this process, putting this together. First, we would like to thank Aaron Carter, Carolee Corthran, and Christina Luzaraga. They were guest artists and instructors throughout our time here at OU, helping us out. Also like to thank Andy Diamond and David Haugen, directors of the thesis productions. And David Haugen also helped with casting the readings. Also thank you to Emily Prince, the dramaturg for the Martha Mitchell project. Thanks as well to Jeanette Buck, the OU production manager. Thanks as well to Ree Moody, who is Playfest production manager. Thanks to our Playfest stage managers, Annie Beller, Beatrice Feldbush, Aaron Galvin, and Connor Sells. Thanks to Gabriel Hrin, who put together all the technical stuff for our, you know, the broadcasting stuff for our thesis productions. Much appreciated in this situation. Thanks as well to Marilyn Krupa, who put together the festival poster. And then finally, thanks to Matthew Schaftel, the Dean of the College of Fine Arts. Cool. Mary, do we have anything else to go over? Are we about ready to get started with Stephen's play?
I think we're ready to get started with Stephen's play. Thanks,
everyone. All right. Up first this year, we have Woog Among the Waves by first-year writer Stephen Strafford. The play runs about 2 hours and 10 minutes, and it includes a 10-minute intermission. And then after, and then there'll be a 10-minute break following the play, after which please return for feedback from Martine Key Green Rogers, Laura Jacqmin, and Tammy Winters. So sit back, relax, and enjoy A Woog Among the Waves by Stephen Strafford.
A Woog Among the Waves, a full-length play by Stephen Strafford. Cast. Steph. 40s. Deb, 60s, Steph and Brian's mom. Nora, 16, Steph and Alan's daughter. Johnny, Steph and Brian's dad, shows signs of dementia. Brian, Steph's brother. Sean, 24, he is dating Brian. Alan, Steph's husband. Lights up on a living room. It's a nice enough home, but it shouldn't look like the homes of the donors to your theater. It should look like the homes of the patrons who come and buy hot ticks or whatever cheap ticket service you use. Pre-show music are songs from the 60s and early 70s. As lights come up, the song playing changes from house speakers to speakers in Johnny's room off stage. It's kind of loud. Steph is on her phone.
Uh-huh. Okay. Okay. Right.
Music gets louder.
Can you repeat that? You know what? Can you hold on just 1 second? Dad? Dad, lower the music, please. I'm on the phone, Dad.
Music lowers.
Right. So you were saying?
Music gets louder.
I'm so sorry. Can you just hold on another second? Dad! Your music, Dad? I'm on the phone.
Sorry, Woog.
Don't call me that. I'm so sorry. My dad. Yeah, exactly. So I'm calling for the results on two tests. Oh, really? Huh. No, it just feels like the sort of thing you just get told, if not in person, at least out loud. Okay. I'll keep an eye out for the link. Have a good day. Bye.
Music turns off.
Thanks, Dad. Perfect timing.
What?
Nothing, Dad. Nora? Nora Jane? I will not call again. Nora!
I thought you said you wouldn't call again.
Nora, can you just answer when I call you?
I know, Mom. I'm the worst.
You're joking, but it's true.
So why are you shouting for me?
I've put your stuff in a pile. Can you carry it up to your room?
Yep, you got it.
Oh, you're a saint.
The music starts up again.
How's DJ Dementia?
Nora, that's not funny.
I mean, it's a little funny.
He keeps playing his music so loud.
I've got this. Old man, turn that music off.
The music is turned off.
Sorry, Woog.
So that guy?
Are you referring to your grandfather?
I mean, he's your father, so I guess, but like, he's not my gramps or my grandpa or anything. That guy is just a guy who lives here now.
That guy is your grandfather.
Maybe that's what I'll call him. Grandfather. I could use a British accent. Hello, grandfather. How's your Alzheimer's today?
Nora Jane.
I don't understand why we ended up with him.
It's complicated. Parents get old, they get sick.
But like, for you to take care of him. I mean, you're sick, Mom.
I'm fine, Nora. I just have a little bit of cancer.
And like, he's so weird. He calls you that weird name, Woog. What's a Woog?
He's called me that my whole life. So a Woog is me, I guess.
Why Woog?
I don't know. You should ask him.
Maybe I'll just ask Grandma instead.
Solid plan.
Have you heard back about the tests?
I was just on the phone with them, but no word yet. We should hear soon via email. Isn't that strange?
Is it?
Well, it just feels like the kind of thing you'd talk about in person, or at the very least out loud.
I guess. All I'm saying is, a week ago, a man I don't know at all moves in here and calls you weird names, and I'm just supposed to, like, what, care about him?
You're supposed to bring your shit upstairs.
Language. But honestly, Mom, everything you've ever said about him before and everything Grandma says, isn't he like a liar? Like, how do you even know he's sick?
Nora, he says he's been to doctors. There's records. Now, bring
my shit upstairs. Look at me go.
Sometimes you have to do what's right, even if people haven't been the best at doing right themselves. That's life. He has nowhere to go and people change. So you give them a second chance. Family means doing the right thing by your people, even if they don't deserve it. Did you hear me, Nora?
Mom, I'm very busy trying to put my things away so my room is perfect in honor of the continued presence of my long-lost grandfather.
Steph goes to fold laundry in the basket.
Someone need me?
No, Dad, no one needs you.
Oh, I thought someone called me.
No, Dad.
Okay. I'm going to go back in the room.
Okay, Dad.
Mom, check your phone. I think Dad texted you.
Oh, really? I didn't hear it. I thought I turned the ringer on.
Mom, we can only have one person with Alzheimer's in this house.
Nora, enough.
I'm getting it out of my system, I promise.
Jesus, your dad wrote me a small novel.
Do you mean novella?
All right, smart ass.
You made me this way.
Yes, I suppose I did.
What did he say?
Seems your dad is held up and won't be able to go to your grandfather's storage unit today to get his medical records.
When's he coming home?
You know, he didn't say. Why?
He was going to drive me to rehearsal.
You're leaving? No. Nora, I need you. We're going over to the restaurant today with the decorations.
Yes, Mom, I'll be back by then, I promise. I have to do my audition coaching with Sean.
Oh, you know it means a lot to your Uncle Brian to give Sean some work while he looks for acting jobs. Is it going well?
Yeah, it's pretty good. Sean says to stand out for college auditions, I need to do something different and personal. He wants me to audition for musical theater programs by deconstructing the form. He's intense, but really fun. Can I get a lift to rehearsal?
Oh, Nora, I would, but I've got your grandma and Uncle Brian coming over.
No, Mom, I mean, like, get a car, like a lift, like the app.
Oh, yeah, sure. You can log in on my computer.
Don't you have it on your phone?
Why would I have it on my phone?
Because that's where people, you know what, it's not important. I'll log in on your computer.
It should open up. I have everything set up for that on there.
So, like, is Grandma so mad that he's staying here? Wait. You haven't told Grandma yet? Mom, oh my God, this is going to be so epic. I mean, like, Grandma's going to lose her mind. Does Grandma even know he's sick? Will that matter? Should I stay and watch? Oh, what a time to be alive.
Nora, go to your rehearsal.
Mom, you have to tell her right away. You can't try to hide a whole human being from her.
Nora Jane, enough. It's going to be fine.
It's gonna be a shit show.
Language, please. Listen, your mom has made some choices that are not ideal, but your mom also has a complicated relationship with her family. And while I can't rewrite the last 4 years of my life, I can clean and make this place nice for your grandmother's arrival, where I will tell her that her ex-husband, who she hates with the fire of 1,000 suns, her words, that ex-husband is living here now. So, if you want to keep helping me clean, Nora, great. If not, just go to your rehearsal. And when you're back here, keep the jokes clean and to a minimum, okay?
Okay, yes. I'll keep everything clean, my room and my jokes.
Oh, good. And stop with the jokes about Alzheimer's. It's a sad thing. And every time I laugh at one of your jokes, I'm all but guaranteeing that I will get Alzheimer's. And I will not have cancer and Alzheimer's. I'm putting a hat on a hat, so just quit it.
Wait, does Uncle Brian know?
Yes, he knows. I asked him to tell your grandmother for me, but he's...
a coward.
Yes, it runs in the family.
Mom, you have an email that says results, and I clicked it.
Who did what?
It was open, and all your passwords just happen automatically.
Nora, you can't just go snooping wherever you want to.
I'm sorry, Mom, I just figured you'd want to know.
Yes, of course I want to know, but Nora... you know what, kid? You're very mature, and you make me laugh, but that doesn't mean you just get to do whatever you want all the time. This is my information for my eyes. Do you hear me? Are you hearing me, Nora?
Yes, Mom. I'm sorry. I just wanted to see.
Did you read this?
Yeah.
Nora, I really wish you hadn't.
Mom, it's not like I don't know what's going on.
That is not the point. I know we get along, and I'm very happy about that, but I need you to respect my boundaries.
I'm sorry, it's not good news.
Yeah. Me too.
So if Grandma and Uncle Brian aren't matches, can I get tested now?
Nora, we talked about this.
You said you'd think about it.
Nora, you know as well as I do. I say that to avoid telling you no. Listen to me. I am not having you do this. It's a very painful procedure, and besides, you're a kid. A smart kid. A great kid. But you're a kid. I know you want to help, but when I need your help, I'll ask you, okay?
I just don't understand why I can't.
Nora Jane, end of conversation. Okay?
Okay, yes, Mom.
Good answer.
So what now?
Well, I continue with the meds. I get on a wait list, and there is still one person related to me in this house who can help.
You mean grandfather?
Yes, grandfather.
Will you ask him today?
Well, consent is a little tricky, you know, ethically speaking.
Because of the dementia?
Exactly. But here's the thing. And don't say anything to anyone about this, okay? But I think you might be right about him. I'm not sure, but I think he might not be telling the truth about his dementia.
Whoa! Would he go that far? Like, fake his dementia? That's some next-level conspiracy stuff, Mom. So, do you need me to investigate? Look through his things, his emails?
Nora, relax. You've looked through enough people's emails today. You know, you really need to respect people's boundaries.
Mom, I don't know how you expect me to prove that he's lying by respecting his boundaries. Tell me what I can do to help.
Nora, you help me by going to your rehearsal. You help me by getting into all the colleges you want to go to. You know, I'm not quite done being mad at you for snooping where you're not supposed to.
I know. I am sorry, Mom. I mean it. I'll quit snooping. Unless you explicitly ask me to snoop, I'll await your cry for help.
There's beeping outside.
Do you need me to go out and cancel the car? Like, do you need me to stay? There's a lot happening here.
No, go rehearse with Sean, and he can bring you here and meet up with Uncle Brian after I've told your grandmother about your grandfather's lives right here. Your grandfather lives here now.
Okay, Mom, I hope it goes well. But one thing, it's pronounced grandfather. Love you, bye.
Steph checks the time. She goes to a table or counter and starts pulling out pills from pill bottles. Maybe she takes the pills dry the way people who take a lot of pills do. She gathers up the clothes. She brings them upstairs.
Hey, Dan, you want to play cards?
You say something?
I said, do you want to play cards?
You want to play cards?
Yes, Dad, I do.
Okay.
Play cards.
Okay, I'll get the cards. You want to play gin?
Ah, gin sounds great. Dad, you want anything? Coffee or?
No, I'm fine. Sit down. You should rest more.
How are you feeling?
I feel okay. Shuffle and deal.
Steph takes cards. She shuffles and then deals.
So, Alan's not able to go to your storage unit today. He's held up at work. So maybe I'll go a little later on after I go to the restaurant. You said your records are there, right? What?
Nothing.
Dad.
I don't know. It's nothing.
Dad, I swear to God.
It's just that Alan.
Oh, God, Dad. What?
Alan gets held up a lot. Work stuff, running errands always taking longer than he thought.
And?
I'm just saying that it sounds a lot like things I said to your mom. Don't get me wrong, I like Alan.
No, you don't. Now, not that you know him enough to like him or not like him. You've spent a total of what? 9 days with him? And the 2 days you spent wasted at our wedding feel like they don't necessarily count.
Okay, Steph. Okay. What do I know? Can't trust this brain these days.
Dad, don't make this about... You're wrong about Alan. Can we just play cards?
Yes, I'm waiting for you to shuffle and deal.
Dad, I already shuffled. Okay, yes, I'll shuffle and deal. Alan is not you, Dad. Just because you lied all the time doesn't make you an expert on when other people are lying about the records.
Who's lying?
No one, Dad. No one is lying.
I'm not lying. I'm not. You always think I'm lying, but I'm not.
Dad, no one said you're lying.
I know you're upset with me.
That's okay.
No, it isn't. It's over between me and Susan. I promise. I won't see her anymore.
Dad, I think...
I need you to believe me. It's over. I want to stay here with you and the kids. I'm going to be a better dad. I'm going to show up. You'll see, Deb. I need you to hear me.
Dad, I'm not... Dad. Hey, you want to shuffle and deal, Dad? You wanted to play gin with me, with Stephanie, right?
What? Oh, yeah.
There's knocking on the front door.
Shit. Dad, get in your room.
What?
Get in your room now, Dad. It's Ryan, he and Mom are here.
Oh, your mother.
Yeah, so I need you to go sit in your room quietly.
You really should tell your mother I'm here.
Should I? You think? Just go to your room and sit quietly, please.
Of course, Woog.
Dad, don't call me that.
Okay, Steph. Okay, I'll go sit.
Quietly.
Yes, quietly. You let me know when I can come out.
I will, Dad.
Good luck, Woog.
There's more knocking. Doorbell added. Steph opens the door.
Hey!
Hey, how are you?
We are early, which is my fault, and we are tired, and that is the fault of your brother's podcasts. Hello.
What's wrong with podcasts?
Nothing's wrong with them. Does something have to be wrong with them for me to be tired of them? It just seems that if I wanted to hear so much talking, I'd have a conversation.
We talked for half the way over.
You're not hearing me. I'm not saying we should have talked more. Stephanie asked how I was. I am tired. I explained why I am tired. But if you want to know what it's like to interview a murderer on death row, by all means, ask me because I am now an expert. Speaking of tired, now you look tired.
Have you been listening to podcasts? I hear podcasts can be exhausting. How's it been going here?
Fine. Mom, you want some tea, some water? I think we have Entenmann's too.
Just the tea.
Okay, Brian, tea?
What? Yes, tea, sure, thanks.
Have you heard anything back about the tests?
Mom, she'll tell us if she's heard.
Brian, it's all right. No, Mom, I haven't heard back yet.
Electric kettle is put on.
Your home has a smell.
Mom.
Why, thank you.
I can't place it, but there's a smell here. A familiar smell. It's not a bad smell, but I don't like it. Where's Alan? Is he at work again? Now, Brian's giving me the don't talk about it eyes. Honestly, it's just a question. The last time I came over, Alan was at work. On the weekend. I'm just wondering if that's where he is now. At work. On the weekend. I'm not asking some deep philosophical question.
No, Mom. You're stirring the pot.
Pots need stirring or they burn.
You know what? I'll take the Entenmann's.
I'm just asking a question.
One piece of cake.
And, Stephanie, you are not answering me.
It's just... I'm so busy getting cake and making tea.
Fine, don't tell me. I'm going to slip off to the little girl's room. Maybe you can tell your brother all the things you refused to tell me.
Yes, Mom, we will share all our secrets while you're in the bathroom.
You're joking, but it's true.
Steph walks a piece of cake over.
I can't have that cake.
Okay.
Don't take it away. I can't have it, but... I want it.
Brian.
Leave the cake, but don't let me eat it. Do you know what Sean called me the other day?
What?
He called me his, cuddle bear.
Oh, that's cute.
It's a nightmare, Stephanie. When a 24-year-old dancer calls you a cuddle bear, he means at. He means you're old and fat.
Well, you're not fat.
But I am old, older than him anyway.
Everyone is older than him.
I'm just not ready to graduate up the ladder of gay animal groups. I'm too young and thin to be a bear.
So, no cake.
No, leave the cake. You know, Mom hates that I'm dating him. She thinks he's too young and she thinks he's dumb. Do you think he's dumb? He does misuse words a lot.
Everyone misuses words.
No, he, like, really misuses words. Like, he calls everything he doesn't like redundant. I didn't like that restaurant. It's redundant.
Oh, that's...
I know! But he's so cute and so nice. And when it's just the two of us, it's great. Anyway, how crazy is it that Mom can smell Dad? She can smell him. Where is he?
He's right over there.
God, I haven't seen him in so long. How does he look? Does it look bad? Is it terrible having him here? You know, I bet he wouldn't give me a hard time about Sean. He's always dating younger women. Oh God, am I like Dad? Well, is it? Does he?
Is it? Does he? What?
Is it terrible? Does he look bad?
You're being a lot.
I had extra caffeine this morning trying to ride the time with Mom with grocery aisle stimulants. Also, by the way, you do look tired. Are you sure everything's okay?
Neither one of you is a match.
What? Shit. God, Stephanie.
But I'm going to ask Dad to take the test.
Is that a good idea, Steph? Like, in his state?
Yeah, I haven't figured out that part yet, but doesn't it feel like he's supposed to do it? Like, he shows up right now when I need him. It's like the universe is making it so he can show up for me, you know?
I don't think that's how the universe works, Steph.
Noise from Mom in the bathroom.
Shit, she's coming back. I'm doing it. I'm telling her now.
Okay, well, what do you need from me?
I need you to be supportive, stay on my side, no matter what.
Okay, I will. But next time she digs at me about Sean's age, you have to stand up for me.
Oh my God, Brian. Fine, I will defend you and your child bride.
See, it's comments like that that...
Brian!
Do you want me sitting or standing?
Who cares?
Okay, I'm gonna sit.
Brian sits, Mom reenters. Brian stands, then sits, then stands, then slowly sits. Deb allows this dance of Brian's to subside.
I smell your father. Did he visit? Did he visit and you didn't tell me? Steph, you know how I feel about you keeping things from me.
Mom, Dad didn't visit.
All right, Steph wouldn't keep something like that from you.
Brian.
I'm being supportive.
Mom, what I'm saying is...
At that moment, music begins blasting from the other room. It's Tonight's the Night by Rod Stewart. Steph walks over to the door. She pounds on the door. The music stops.
He's here?
Yes.
He's in this house?
Yes.
I knew I smelled him.
That was really uncanny, Mom.
Did you know your father was here?
No.
Brian?
Yes, but it's a long story and...
Is this some kind of ambush?
No, Mom. Stephanie wanted to tell you, but...
But what?
I don't know. I just assumed Steph will finish that sentence.
This is help. This is what help looks like, Brian. I was scared to tell you that Dad was living here now.
He's living here. John, get out here.
Mom.
I cannot for the life of me understand how you could have him live with you after disappointing you time and again.
Mom, he has Alzheimer's.
He, what?
Deb, Brian, Steph, and Johnny all hold their place. No one says anything. Brian begins to eat his cake.
Damn family reunion!
Brian, be quiet.
Copy that. Hey, Dad.
Hey, buddy. Hi, Deb.
I thought you said he has Alzheimer's.
Yes.
Then how does he remember me?
Mom, that's not how it works.
He's supposed to remember me then? Does Alzheimer's make you have a better memory?
Obviously not, but...
Deb, it doesn't happen all at once, or all the time, but I'm sick. I couldn't live on my own anymore.
So you take him in? Now you and your father are, what, so close?
Mom, he's sick.
No, he's not.
Deb, I know you're probably still mad at me.
I'm not mad at you. I have no feelings about you whatsoever. It has been decades since I've had a feeling about you. He's faking it. He probably ran up debts and owes someone a lot of money and he's hiding out here.
Jesus, Mom.
Don't you remember how it was with him? Never showing up, one scam after another, leaving us with no money, no anything. Stephanie, did he just reach out of nowhere, out of the blue, saying he was sick? The man is a user. He's a scammer and he's lying. That's what he does.
Mom, enough. Come on.
Why are you hiding? Is it money or a woman? Or both?
I don't know what to tell you, Deb. I'm sick. And Steph has been so good to me to take me in. I know I don't deserve...
You know what? Save it. Stephanie, you need to be taking care of yourself. But by all means, use up your energy taking care of your father. He's faking this disease because he needs something. And when you find out that I was right, I will be here. Like I have always been here for you. I need to go. I can't be here right now.
Mom, we need to talk about your party tomorrow.
Cancel it.
Mom, I put down a deposit.
I'll send you the money on that app.
It's called Venmo.
Yes, I'll Venmo you.
No, it's Venmo with a V.
Ryan, who cares? Mom, don't be ridiculous. We're not canceling the party.
I'm not kidding, Stephanie. I'm too upset to enjoy a party. Brian, are you coming?
Sean has my car and was going to meet me here in a couple of hours.
Oh, is he old enough to drive now? That's so good. Good for him.
I'm not the one harboring Dad in my home.
Thanks, Brian. Super helpful.
I'm sorry. I was on the defensive.
Goodbye. Happy birthday to me.
Your mom seemed...
She did, Dad. She really did.
I'm going to...
Yep.
It's good to see you, Dad.
Yep. You too, buddy.
You. You did not stand by me.
I did what I could given the heightened nature of the situation. Need another piece of cake.
You can get it yourself. Jesus, Brian, that went badly.
Exceptionally so. Like, really, really, really bad.
Oh, thank you. Hey. Where are you? What's that noise? Okay. Do you need to go? I can call back. Well, I just told her, so now she knows. It was terrible, cataclysmically terrible. Yeah, sure, go ahead. I called Alan.
I figure.
Brian serves himself another piece of cake.
I'm not eating this piece of cake.
Why not?
Because I'm fat.
We're not fat.
I'm not fat for a straight guy, but for a gay guy, I'm an elephant.
Oh, see, that's the animal you can be.
You're the worst.
Alan? Sorry, I missed that. Brian was saying he's fat. Oh, Alan says you're not fat. He says you're more like a cuddle bear.
What? Did he really say that?
No, of course not. Okay, you don't have to apologize. I just wanted to see if you could maybe reschedule what you've got going on and go to storage and look for Dad's records. Okay. I'll see if Brian can go with me. Yep. Okay. Love you too.
What was all that about?
Oh, Alan can't do it. He's tied up right now.
Okay.
Don't.
Don't worry. I won't ask about the whole Alan situation.
There is no Alan situation.
Right. Got it. There's absolutely no Alan situation.
You want to take a drive to storage with me?
It's my only wish.
Dad, we're heading out. Be home soon. Don't burn the house down. We don't have good enough insurance.
Is he okay to be home by himself?
Yeah, it'll be fine.
Okay. Bye, Dad. Love you. So why are we going to the storage unit?
Because I think Mom is right. I think Dad is lying.
Intrigue.
Did someone call me? Hello?
Johnny pulls his phone out from his robe pocket. He looks around.
Steph? Brian? Hello? Can we talk?
Lights fade. Music lights up on Brian and Steph in the car. They're driving in silence.
Are you okay?
I'm fine. You know, some part of me never believed him, but then he had this episode while we were playing cards. But then when Mom just said it out loud, he's faking it. I don't know. Didn't it feel true?
Well, Dad
is a faking faker liar who's lied our whole lives.
I might not have put it exactly that way, but yes.
Is being a man what makes you lie? Does it make you a liar at birth?
Is this about Dad or Alan?
Why does everyone keep bringing up Alan? Alan is fine. Everything is fine, Brian. We are fine.
Okay. Glad to hear it. It's just, you're always talking about how much he's away and how he constantly has these errands to run. Like, doesn't it sound exactly like Dad with Mom?
Drop it.
Yep.
Nora's really enjoying her time with Sean.
Well, good. Thanks for giving him that job. It means a lot to him getting to do what he loves.
Well, it's our pleasure. And Nora says they're coming up with this completely original piece for her college auditions. And I think she likes spending time with a coach who's closer to her age.
There it is.
I'm sorry. I know it drives you crazy.
Look, I get it. He's younger than me. But fielding nonstop jokes from you and mom and my friends and my coworkers. And it's not like that I don't think about it too. Did I tell you? He started telling me I'm not fun.
Really? Yikes.
Right? I'm fun. Oh God, am I no fun?
You're delightful. He's just young, and young people require a lot of fun.
Yeah, you know, here's some life advice for you. There are more questions than answers in the ass of a 24-year-old dancer.
Wow, thanks. I'll be sure to remember that.
I'm just being stupid. He's so kind and sweet. He's fine. We're fine.
Look at us. Both of us in relationships that are doing fine.
Yep. Good for us. So, want to talk about the tests?
No.
Cool. Are you sure?
Look, I wanted it to work out, but it didn't work out. I mean, it's cancer, Brian. It's not like it's life and death. Jeez.
Would it be crazy to ask Nora?
I am not putting Nora through that. Not just the procedure part. What if she's not a match and she thinks somehow it's her fault? The amount of time I spent thinking Dad not being home was my fault. Nora having my life on her hands, she already has to be so much older than everyone else her age with all this. So no, I'll get Dad to do it.
You have one audio message from Mom. You have one audio message from Mom. You have one audio message from Mom.
Wait, what is happening?
I guess Mom is ready to talk.
Who even taught her to audio text?
She's not 90.
It was you.
It was me.
Jesus, how do I respond? Do I have to respond to audio messages with audio messages?
Wait, are you 90?
Well, I'm sorry if I'm not up to all the new ways to communicate via text. Oh, maybe if I had a 24-year-old boyfriend with placenta in his eyes, I'd know how to do it.
Okay, first, you literally live with a teenager in your home. So you could possibly learn about text communication with her. And two, what does that even mean? Placenta in his eyes?
I guess it doesn't completely work.
No, it doesn't. I get your point. He's a baby. Ha ha ha. And you're freaked out about Mom, so you get a pass.
Thank you, and I'm sorry.
Steph begins pulling into parking lot for the storage unit.
Okay, here's how you handle this. Text Mom. Tell her that you saw that she texted audio messages. Maybe make a joke about how advanced she is technologically. Tell her you'll listen to them once you're done at the storage unit. That way she knows that you've seen the messages exist, but she'll have to relax into hearing your response.
You are eerily good at this.
My boyfriend is a brand new penny. I need to be good at these things. Do you want me to come in?
No, that's okay. Yes, I do. I'm going to call Nora and then we can look for the records and then I'll deal with Mom.
All right, let's go try and prove Dad's lying. We really do the best family things.
They leave the car, transition back to house, lights up as Nora enters on the phone with her mom, followed by Sean. Johnny is on the phone.
I promise I will. You have to believe me. If I can keep staying here, I can sit. Oh, I have people here, Father Bill. I appreciate the counsel. Thank you. Bye.
Actually, Mom, he's here in the living room right now. Yep. Will do. Hey.
Me?
Yeah. Mom says she and Uncle Brian just got to the storage unit and she's double-checking that your records are there.
Yes, all of my records are there.
He says all of his records are in the storage unit. Okay, bye, Mom. No, Mom, I won't do anything but keep an eye on him.
Hi, Johnny. It's me, Sean. I'm Brian's boyfriend. Brian, your son.
Yes. It's good to see you, Sean. Hey, kid. Where are you all coming from?
Sean was helping me with my college auditions.
Oh, your mom was a great performer when she was young. I think she kept doing it in high school, but then she gave it all that up. Glad to hear you're picking it up. Yeah, I always thought I'd be good at that stuff.
Well, being good at pretending helps.
I'm an actor, singer, dancer myself, and now add to the list an audition coach. So many hats, but it all falls underneath. It all falls under the umbrella of performer.
I would guess so.
How are you feeling? Do you need water? When was the last time you hydrated?
Well, I don't know. Sean? It's Sean, isn't it?
Yes, it is Sean.
Sean, could you get my water bottle for me? It's in my room right there. Thank you. I can't quite remember where in there.
Say no more. I'm on it.
I didn't know you were religious.
I seek the counsel of a priest from time to time. Do you think you heard something strange?
When?
When I was on the phone.
Why? What were you saying?
Nothing. Just talking to my priest.
Then I guess I heard what you said. Nothing. To a priest.
Johnny, are you sure it's in here? I can't seem to find it.
I thought I had it in there.
Oh, don't worry. I'll find it.
Thank you. I know you don't trust me, kid. And maybe that's smart. I wasn't always great with the truth. Maybe you heard that?
Yeah. I've heard a couple of stories.
Well, you know, I probably could have done better. Shown up more. Made less excuses. That's why it's so great of your mom and dad to take me in.
Well, I looked all over and I couldn't find it. I'm just gonna get a glass of water from the kitchen for you.
Thank you, Sean.
Of course, happy to help.
We should talk more. I think you heard something you didn't hear.
Oh, here we are, one glass of water. So, what now?
I'd say we hang out and wait until they get back, and then we can go from there.
Cards?
Perfect.
I'll get them.
Well, this is gonna be so much fun.
Lights transition to Steph and Brian stepping into the storage unit, which triggers the automatic sensor light. There are crates and crates of record albums.
He said records. He said all his records are here.
Well, he wasn't lying. There are indeed a lot of records here. Did you say medical records? Like, when you asked about the records, you specifically said we need your medical records, not we need your records? Knowing the man plays music constantly.
Of course I told him we needed his medical records. At least I think I did.
And did he say the words medical records or just records? Because there are definitely records, but no medical records.
Stop saying records. Let me text Nora, have her ask Dad where to look.
So many albums. Hey, so can I ask you a question?
Oh, is it about my marriage? Then go ahead.
So, you prove Dad's lying. And then what? Like, I guess I don't know why you just don't...
Ask him? Well, for one thing, he can't consent to the transplant, let alone the test, if he has dementia.
So if you prove that he doesn't have dementia...
Exactly.
Yeah, that's all sort of tricky.
Also, I feel like if I don't ask him publicly, like with tons of people around, he won't commit to it.
He's a lot of things, but I feel like he wouldn't say no to this, right?
Remember me asking him to the daddy-daughter dance?
Vaguely.
I asked him in sixth grade and he just avoided giving me an answer. And I asked him in seventh grade and he sort of said yes, but I couldn't lock him down.
Oh my God, that's right. You asked him at the end of the eighth grade recital.
I finished singing and asked him from the stage. It was a whole production.
That was deeply embarrassing.
It was sweet. I was sweet, Brian. It was like a proposal the kids do in school now.
Exactly. Embarrassing.
He said yes because he was in front of all those people. He said yes because I cornered him publicly. I remember feeling like I finally figured him out. Finally figured out to make him show up.
I think maybe you're learning the wrong lesson from this memory because I ended up taking you to the dance, right? I'm pretty sure Mom always points to the pictures from the dance as the most handsome I've ever looked, which feels like a sideways insult to how I've looked for the last 25 years.
Yeah, you did. For weeks leading up to that dance, I would talk to Dad on the phone. Dad, I got a fancy dress today. Dad, you have to remember to get a corsage. And Dad kept saying how excited he was to take me to the dance. And Mom would say, you should ask your brother. Your father will not show up. And I'd yell at her, telling her she didn't understand anything. And just because Dad didn't love her enough to stay with her didn't mean he wouldn't show up for me. It's like I brought this whole Alan situation on myself by saying such terrible things to her as a kid.
So there is an Alan situation?
Brian, leave it alone.
It just feels like you want to talk about it.
I promise that if I want to talk about it, I will say I want to talk about Alan. Okay?
Okay.
Anyway, the day of the dance, all day long, as Dad kept on not showing up, she kept asking me, do you want me to get your brother? And I'd say, no. And you were at church youth group. You were at a church youth group meeting, which feels like a part I must have made up.
No, that's right. I love that youth group.
Yeah.
What can I say? I contain multitudes.
Well, Mom kept telling me, I have your brother's suit pressed, so why don't I go get your brother? And I kept telling her no, yelling at her, but she just kept asking. And then she asked one more time, and I didn't say anything. I just sat in my fancy dress and looked away. She didn't ask again. She just left to go get you, and she didn't say, I told you so, or you should have listened to me. All she did was that double sigh. The mouth and nose one.
Yes. Oh, this one?
Yes, that's the one. And I never brought it up again. Neither did Mom. And Dad certainly never did. But all these years later, I remember that night so well.
Mm, I remember that night too.
Yeah?
Yeah. When Mom got to the youth group meeting, she found me in the boys' bathroom with my hand down Tommy Donovan's pants.
Wait, what?
Yeah, Adrian Krumkowski ratted me out. She was the worst.
What did Mom say?
She said, Brian, your sister needs you. Tommy, tuck in your shirt.
Mom!
Indeed!
Oh my God. So when Dad reached out, I guess I wanted to believe that after all this time, if given the chance to repay me, if given the chance to show up, finally, he could do better. We could do better. And since he needed me, I'd be in control and he could finally be in my life.
I don't understand how you don't just give up on him. It's like some part of you wants to find out he's telling the truth.
No, I don't. Shut up. I want to prove he's lying so he can help me.
So the reason you let him live with you was to harvest his bone marrow?
Brian, that is not what I'm doing.
I mean, I wouldn't be mad at you if you were.
He said he was sick and needed help, so I took him in. He's family.
Oh, I get it. All I'm saying is it's okay if taking him in was a little transactional.
Not everyone is transactional around relationships, Brian.
I'm sorry. Are you calling me transactional?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
I mean, it sounds like that's what you're saying. Go on, say what you're gonna say.
I just mean that you date these young men and you get what you want, which is maybe, and I'm just guessing here, to feel young. And then when you get close, you find some sort of thing you don't like about them, maybe that you never liked, maybe something that you never liked about them. And maybe if you don't wall yourself off from being vulnerable, from being fun, you'd be happy, or you'd leave them and find someone you actually want to be with and you wouldn't get left.
Oh, okay. So now we're telling the truth in the storage locker? Okay then, Steph. You have this picture of Dad as making time for you. Like those visits when you remember Dad coming into town being so fun. There were times he had to come to town because he ran out of money and had nowhere else to go. So he'd beg Mom to stay with us. They weren't movie dates. They weren't him choosing to have fun with you. They were him getting out of trouble and you were convenient. I'm not saying you and he didn't have something real. You did. He was always closer to you, and I get that. I just shut myself off from him for the first time he didn't show up for a big thing. But you always give him more chances. And now you're giving Alan all these chances to show up, and how is that working out? I'm just saying that if you need Dad in your home to get something from him, well, that's fine. But if you need more from him, like if you need him to be your dad and take care of you, Steph, I need you to brace yourself for not getting what you want.
I don't need that. That's not what I want from him.
Okay. Well, good. Because I don't think he has it to give to you, Steph. Sometimes you can't get what you want from people you want it from. If you want to laugh, fine, Dad's your guy. If you want to play cards, great, but don't expect a parent to all of a sudden appear in his place.
I'm not a child, Brian. I'm not sitting in my party dress waiting for him to show up this time. I'm going to expose him as a fake, and I'm going to make him admit it. And then he's going to give me what I need so he can stay in my home.
So it's revenge.
It's not. God, it's revenge? Do you think I'm a terrible person?
No, don't get me wrong. I'm not opposed to revenge. I'm just saying, I'm just trying to name what's going on here. Like with the cancer and with Alan and everything else that you have going on, you're spending a lot of time and energy on this Dad thing.
Well, Brian, I'm sorry if you feel that your time's being wasted.
That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying maybe look at what you're really after and set yourself a realistic goal.
Text notification.
I appreciate what you're saying. I do, but it's not necessary. I've got this. I just need to figure out a way to get him to fess up, and then it will be easier to ask him to do this thing for me. I don't need to publicly shame him or whatever.
Not that it wouldn't be satisfying to see him publicly shamed.
I just need to figure out how to make it so that he can't wriggle out of this lie with more lies. Okay, Dad says we should look in the box marked personal.
Oh, right. Gotcha. Personal. Hey, would you look at that? There's a box in that crate. And it's marked personal.
Grab it. You know what? Let's grab some records too. Dad will like that. And Brian, I'm sorry about the armchair psychology earlier. Date who you want. Sean is adorable.
He is. He is very adorable. Oh shit, Mom's messages.
Right, shit. Jesus Christ, Mary and Saint Joseph. Let's do this.
She hits play. As she plays them, we see Deb appear.
Hello, Stephanie. It's your mother. I wanted to start by saying I'm not mad at you. A little disappointed, but not mad. And...
Hey, not too bad.
Deb hits play on the second message.
I was cut off. I don't like this voice text. It seems to think my voice is a robot or a button on the phone or something. It's always cutting me off, but this way I can speak my mind and not have you interrupt me over and over.
I could listen to these all day.
Steph presses play.
You know what? I am about ready to throw this phone in a river. The first of these messages haven't even sent yet. Do I need to be connected to the Wi-Fi for this to work? Anyhow, I love you. I'm coming over in a bit. I want to talk. Also, I canceled the party at the restaurant. I emailed all the guests telling them I'm not feeling well, so we can just have a small thing at your house tomorrow night. Do not decorate or anything like that. I do not want to fuss. I covered the deposit for the restaurant, so no worries about the money. See you in a bit. No need to call back.
This, Brian? This is going to be a whole thing.
They exit with a box marked personal and a crate of records, transition back to house. We join Sean mid-story. They are playing cards.
And we toured that show for a year. I was fresh out of school and I wasn't sure if I was up to it. To be honest, it was a really hard schedule, but completely worth it. It's a rigorous show and it took a lot out of me, but we were helping people, really doing the work, you know, like really showing up, really changing lives.
Which show is this?
Dora the Explorer.
The musical.
Is there a non-musical Dora the Explorer?
There is. Not that anyone would want to see that on tour. It's trash. I loved being on that job, but you know, you can only be passed over for the backpack 3 times before you realize you are not appreciated. Oh, Jen.
You know, I'm getting pretty tired. I think I'm going to lie down.
I'll talk to you later, grandfather.
Nora, you didn't tell me you can do accents.
Everyone has their secrets.
You know, that's true. I always feel like your Uncle Brian is keeping things in. Not secrets, but more just what he's feeling. He's so bottled up. He's so much like my dad in that way.
Grandma, hey!
Nora goes and gives her a big hug, and it is reciprocated plus more.
Hey, how's my favorite granddaughter?
I'm all right.
Hello, Sean.
Hi, Deb.
Runs up and gives her a hug, which is less reciprocated.
Johnny, don't leave on my account.
Deb. Hey.
I want to apologize for my outburst earlier. And I want to say that I'm sorry to hear that you say that you're sick.
It's sad. Ugh, dementia is so redundant.
No, it isn't.
You're right. We should look at the positive side of things. It isn't always redundant.
Grandma, I'm excited for your party tomorrow.
Yes, it's going to be here now. I ordered some deli subs. I didn't need anything so fancy as that party your mom was planning anyhow. And this way we can all be here for my birthday. Just family. And you too, Sean. Nora, why don't you take Sean out of this room so I can speak to your grandfather alone?
Hey, Sean, want to come upstairs and see my playbills from the show I saw on my choir trip to New York?
Sure. What shows did you see?
We saw a bunch. Most were really good.
Did you see Phantom? That show is so redundant.
So?
Yeah.
I think you look good. I was expecting you to look older, I guess.
You look good too, Deb.
I look like my mother.
You look good.
Thank you. So what's your game? What is this?
Deb, I'm sick.
No, your daughter is sick, which I assume you know.
Yes, Deb, I know. But she says it's fine, me being here.
Of course she says it's fine. What else is she gonna say? And you came here because?
I have Alzheimer's, Deb.
That part is hard to believe, John. Cancer? Heart disease, that runs in your family, but this stuff, not so much.
It's Alzheimer's. I went to the doctor, Deb.
Oh, well, if you went to the doctor. Now it's so much easier to believe a compulsive liar about his made-up disease.
What do you want me to say? I needed somewhere to go. And the symptoms come and go a little, but I'm sick, Deb. And it's getting worse.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes. Let's say You're sick.
Which I am.
Sure. And let's say that in being sick, you decide to reach out to one of your children for help, which I gotta admit, John, took confidence. Could you understand why that would upset someone who raised those kids for you?
Deb, can we do this another time? I'm tired. I didn't mean to upset you.
If I had a dollar for every time you said that sentence, I wouldn't have needed to declare bankruptcy from the debts you left me with.
Deb.
Which, by the way, not that you asked and not for nothing, I got through on my own. And now, after years, I have terrific credit. But who cares? I don't care. I don't care what happens to me. I certainly don't care what happens to you. Alzheimer's? Who cares? I don't. What I care about are my kids.
Deb, I need you. You just can't yell at me like this. I need you. You just need to stop.
I won't stop.
You need to be quiet. Just be quiet. Just be quiet.
This is what you fight with me about? John, I swear to God, if you've come here and you hurt my kids again, I will kill you. I will see you lying dead on the ground. And Johnny, hear me when I say that I will enjoy every last second of it.
Mom, you're here.
I am.
How's it going? Everyone getting along?
It's fine, Brian. We're fine. We were just talking.
Yeah, Dad, you okay? You look a little,
I'm fine, Woog.
Don't call her that. She hates that.
She used to love that name.
She also loved playing Battleship. Would you suggest we play a game now?
Mom, calm down.
I'm calm.
You're prosecutorial.
Well, maybe I am, but I'm calm.
Or...
Don't you start.
I said one word.
Mom, leave Brian alone. Dad, why don't you go lie down?
He's fine.
Mom.
John, did I physically hurt you? Not that any court in America wouldn't find it justifiable. All right, I hear the prosecutorial thing. I hear it. Is Alan not home yet?
Deb, leave it be.
You don't get to tell me what to
leave. All right. Enough. Everyone just take it down a notch.
Yeah, let's all just... Dad, we brought some more of your records from storage.
Oh, great. Just drop them in here.
Sure thing.
Babe, is that you?
Yeah, we're down here.
Oh, great. Be right down.
Thanks, son.
Sure thing, Dad.
Hey, did you know I've been using the word redundant wrong?
Have you?
Apparently. Nora just told me, and I was like, I use that word all the time. Why didn't you tell me?
He didn't want to hurt your feelings, Sean.
Mom!
What? It's true. He didn't want you to feel any less smart than you might think that you are.
Mom!
Thanks, Deb. I like that you tell me the truth, at least.
Yes, you can always count on Deb for that.
You're being smart right now, but it's true. And having someone who tells the truth all the time around here maybe doesn't make me the most popular, but...
Makes you right. We know, Mom. Sean, I should have...
Yes, you should have.
And for the record, it means that...
You don't have to tell me. Nora did. And if you told me now, it would be... redundant.
Nora's a regular Annie Sullivan.
Who's Annie Sullivan?
So, Mom, your party.
It's all taken care of. There's nothing for you to do.
But you wanted to be here?
Yes. Since you want your father to be in your life so badly, I think he should at least be in attendance at your mother's birthday party, don't you?
Okay. You want to have this talk now? Come on, and I have the room. Just give us a few minutes.
Oh, hey, what's going
on? Oh, we're coming up there.
Who's fighting now?
No one is fighting. Grandma and I are going to talk.
That's the scariest fight combination.
Nora.
I'm going. Is Dad home yet?
No, he's still out.
Still out running errands.
Steph, he has been gone a long time today.
You know what, Sean? Do you think maybe you can mind your own business and just head upstairs so I can talk to my mom without having to answer to a child with placenta in his eyes about my marriage?
Steph, the placenta thing still makes no sense.
I'm sorry, Sean. I'm sorry. Everyone keeps at me about Alan and...
No, that's okay. You don't have to explain. I'll just head upstairs. Nora, why don't you play us some music you like?
Okay, sounds good.
Ryan, I'm sorry. I'll make it up to him, I promise.
Yes, you should. Hey, babe, don't start the music till I'm up there.
I'm sorry to have caused so much trouble. I didn't mean to upset you all.
Okay, so we're alone. You want to yell at me? Yell.
I'm not going to yell at you, Mom.
I wish you would, you and your brother. You hold on to everything until you make yourself sick.
Yes, Mom, my lack of yelling gave me cancer.
I didn't say that, Stephanie. I just wish you and your brother would speak your minds more.
Mom, the test came back. Neither of you are a match.
Oh, honey. I'm so sorry. When did you find out?
Earlier.
How much earlier? Did you know when I was here today?
Mom, there was a lot going on.
And you told your brother when I was in the bathroom. Didn't I say that you tell the truth when I go pee?
Yes, Mom, you were right. Can we talk about Dad?
Who cares about him? You're sick. You got bad news. Do you have a plan?
I think I do. I mean, the start of one. Mom, how did you know Dad was faking?
Why? Do you think he's faking too?
Yes. I mean, I think so. He just called me out of nowhere. It's suspicious. But I need him to admit it, or I need to find proof. So we went into his storage unit, because if I can prove he's lying, then he can take the test to donate.
Oh, this is going to be so fun. I mean, it's terrible news about the tests, but nailing your father's ass to the wall and catching him in a lie. So what proof did you find?
I haven't found proof yet, but Mom, how did you know he was faking?
The music he plays in his room. Playing that song.
What song?
The song he played when I was here. See, your father, Stephanie, is a creature of habit. We always had London broil on Friday with leftover sandwiches over the weekend. We always opened up that horrible above ground pool you all love so much on Memorial Day, even if it was 50 degrees out. And we always... to that album.
Oh.
I mean sex.
Yeah, Mom, I get it.
That song was how I knew he wanted to. It was what was playing our first time. And your father got in the habit, along with the habit of lying and cheating on me, mind you, of playing that album whenever we did it. It worked for a lot longer than it should have.
So you think Dad wanted to have sex with you the other day?
No, Stephanie. I'm not a 30-year-old divorced bowling alley waitress. I think he played that album on purpose to soften me up. He knew that I'd be on to him, and he wanted me to melt at the memory.
Mom, that sounds... melt? He knows you, right?
He knew me. It used to work. I had a thing for Rod Stewart. A lot of us did them. He'd go off with some woman who'd make him feel like more of a man than his wife and kids did, and then he'd come home and he'd apologize. And eventually, he'd play that album. And in my defense, he always lasted the whole album. He was very good at flipping the record in the middle. That took some skill, considering that we...
Okay, so you think...
I think he played that song on purpose. Yes.
I don't know, Mom.
Does he usually play music?
Yes.
Have you heard him play that song before?
No.
John! Come on. Come out here, John. Come out here.
Did someone call me?
Ugh, is sudden deafness a symptom of Alzheimer's too?
Mom, enough. Dad, go back in your room.
Okay.
Were you calling me? Are we allowed to come back down now?
No.
Great. We'll just keep listening to Sean sing Sondheim.
Mom. I'm scared that if it's left up to me, I'll never ask him. I think the combined forces of you, me, and Nora, yeah, I think we could all get him to crack. Or, I don't know, God. Mom, what if he's telling the truth?
Yeah, he could be telling the truth, Stephanie. And I could be menstruating again, but it's unlikely.
All I'm asking is that you do two things for me.
Name it, and I'll do it.
Okay. I need you to lay off Dad. Like, no direct confrontation at all for the next 24 hours, unless I give you a signal.
What's the signal?
I'll say Rod Stewart.
No, make it someone I don't like. Make it Fergie.
But the Black Eyed Peas?
No, I mean the Duchess of York.
I don't like Fergie.
I hated those diet ads. She was so smug.
Okay, Mom. The code word will be Fergie, I guess. So on Yes, I Love Yell Fergie, you just sit tight. Can you do that?
Yes, I promise. Steph, how are you so calm? How are you not mad at him?
Mom, what good would getting mad do? Just don't instigate anything for 24 hours, okay? Deal?
Yes, deal. I won't press your father about his fabricated dementia that you fell for like someone buying the Brooklyn Bridge.
You're doing great so far, Mom.
I start now. Right now. Now.
Hey, everyone, you can come down now.
Stephanie, you didn't tell me the second thing.
Oh, shit, later. Sorry about all that. Just a mother-daughter moment.
Who won?
You know what? I lost. I wanted to convince Mom to have the party at the restaurant like originally planned, but she insisted we have it here. So that's what we'll do. And since we're having a party tomorrow and we're all also the guests, why doesn't everyone that who doesn't live here head home? Oh, hey, Sean. Sorry about what I said earlier. I really am. You know I think you're great, right?
Oh, that's okay, Steph. Thank you for saying that. And since we're talking, would you mind if I brought over some decorations? Nothing too much. I just hate to see a party without decorations.
You don't have to do that.
You know what, Sean? That would be great. One last thing for me to do.
Stephanie, I don't want a lot of...
Say yes, Deb.
Okay. Sean, that sounds fine. Just nothing too much.
Of course not. I know you by now. Tell me, what do you love? What's your favorite thing?
Oh, I don't know, Sean.
What was your favorite vacation?
I don't know. My favorite...
Mom, didn't you go on a cruise you liked?
Yes. Yes, I did. I went on a cruise, and it was fine. Too much food, but it was nice on the water.
Say no more, Deb. Say no more.
Okay, babe, let's get going.
Okay, cuddle bear.
Bye, Steph. Bye, Nora.
Bye, Uncle Brian. Bye, Sean.
Bye, Nora. Maybe we can have some entertainment tomorrow for the party. Show off all we've been working on. I think it will fit really well with what I've got planned.
I don't know.
Nora, don't you want to perform for your grandmother's birthday?
Okay. Sure, Grandma, for your birthday.
Bye, Deb.
Sean hugs Deb. She participates a bit more this time. He and Brian begin to exit.
Hi, everyone.
Hello, Alan. Where have you been all day?
I was working, Sean.
Alan goes up to Steph to kiss her on the cheek. She flinches, but tries not to flinch.
I'm going to put my stuff upstairs.
Okay, great.
Hey, Dad.
Hey, kiddo.
You were supposed to drive me to rehearsal today.
Sorry, I was stuck doing stuff for work, and I picked Visa. They're as good as new.
Oh, great. Thanks, Dad.
So, we're gonna go. Love you all. Come on, Sean.
And Mom, may I be the first to say happy birthday.
Alan has stopped on the stairs. He is texting someone.
Nora, come give me a hug. Here's my ticket price for tomorrow.
Thanks, Grandma. Hey, Grandma, why do you all call Mom Woog?
You know, it was Johnny who came up with that name. He's always making up nicknames for your mom, like Dibble and Schmoosh and Woog. Well, he never let that one go. His squeezable little Woog. And she's still so squeezable. I love you, my daughter. And so does your father. The shit. Nora, you didn't hear me say that.
Okay, Grandma.
Love you too, Mom. Call me in the morning to coordinate times.
I'll probably just stop by.
Or just stop by.
Hey, what was the second thing you need me to do?
Oh, take this box. Brian said it looked just like old pictures and stuff, but Dad said we'd find what we need in here. So go through it. And if there's a record of him seeing a doctor, then we just drop this whole thing.
Got it.
Thank you. Love you a lot.
You bet. Goodbye, John. Have a good night.
From the room, Tonight's the Night, the sex song begins playing.
That man is the lowest. But it's such a good song.
Deb dances out with the box as she exits. Steph watches her dance.
Nora, about your performance tomorrow, you're doing that dance thing you and Sean made up?
Yeah, why?
I wonder if you'd hear me out about some changes to the script.
Okay. Shall we go to my office?
Yes, let's.
What are you two up to?
Just planning a show, Dad.
Hey, Steph. About today...
Alan, I've got to do this, okay?
I don't want you to think...
Honestly, Alan, I'm not up to this conversation right now. Let me get through my mom's party and then we can talk.
Okay, Steph. Okay.
Alan makes sure she's gone. Double checks. He starts texting.
Hey, Johnny. How are you feeling?
Johnny shuffles over a bit towards Alan.
If you break my daughter's heart, I'll fucking kill you.
Lights out. End of Act One.
Change. problem is all inside your head, she said to me. The answer is easy if you take it logically. I'd like to help you in your struggle to be free. There must be 50 ways to leave your lover. She said it's really not my habit to intrude. Furthermore, I hope my meaning won't be lost or misconstrued. But I'll repeat myself at the risk of being crude. There must be 50 ways to leave your lover. 50 ways to leave your lover. You just slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. Just get yourself free. Or hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee, and get yourself free. Ooh, slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. You just listen to me. Hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee, and get yourself free. She said, it grieves me so to see you in such pain. I wish there was something I could do to make you smile again. I said, I appreciate that. And would you please explain about the 50 ways? She said, why don't we both just sleep on it tonight? And I believe in the morning you begin to see the light. And then she kissed me. I realized she probably was right. There must be 50 ways to leave your lover. 50 ways to leave your lover. You just slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. Just get yourself free. Or you hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee. Slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. You just listen to me. Hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee, and get yourself free.
in the dream that you had so long ago that lives in all of the hearts of people. Dream become a reality. I know we will, because our hearts tell us so.
During intermission, the crew will be adding the decorations from the theater and moving the living room furniture out. I'd love Sean to be involved in this at some point. Sean directing the crew of where to put things. Starting with taking furniture out and then bleeding into bringing the set pieces in. And once set up, we go to Act Two. Lights up on the living room. The room has been transformed. It is decorated with a lot of set pieces from a small regional theater's production of Anything Goes. The hull of a fake ship, a ship's wheel, that pipe thing that looks like a periscope. Fake ocean waves made of wood with paint on them are throughout the living room. There is enough of the set in the house where you feel an uncanny valley between the house and the set of Anything Goes. Furniture has been moved out or pushed against walls. It is a lot. Sean enters with a wrench and begins futzing with a clamp on one of the professional theater lighting instruments. He is dressed like a sailor. He looks adorable. Nora walks down from upstairs.
Hey, Mom, do you know where my copy of The Great Santini is? I can't find it Oh, my God. What happened in here?
Hey, isn't it great?
Yeah, it's great.
I got inspired, so I got a crew together to pick out this stuff and deliver it here.
I guess I didn't expect so much.
Thank you.
Have you seen my mom?
I think she went outside to take a phone call.
Are you doing this all by yourself?
Ryan should be here soon to help with the finishing touches after he gets into costume.
Sean, where's all the furniture? The chairs?
I moved them. There wasn't enough room with the set pieces, and I put the little stage up for your show. You can sit on one of the cubes over there. I put the cubes in the waves. I thought that was a nice touch. Okay, I need to go finish setting up the outside installation before the birthday girl gets here.
But I can't get an appointment? Okay, great. Yes. I'll know for sure today if he can do it. Okay. Okay, have a good day. Bye.
So these decorations.
Oh, yeah, I know. I feel like we're in a video for the village people.
Who are the village people?
Oh, they're like the Mount Rushmore of homosexuals.
I don't get it.
You're the wrong age for the joke. Where's your Uncle Brian? He's my ideal audience.
Sean said he should be here any minute. He's just going home to change into his costume.
Into his what?
I know.
He isn't. Will he be the same as Sean or different? Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Nora, this day is turning around. This whole year, this whole crazy year will turn around if your uncle shows up in a costume. I deserve this.
Who are you on the phone with?
Oh, I'm setting up the appointment for you know who. So if the plan goes well, we can have him go tomorrow morning. You know, I give my brother a hard time about him, but it's nice having Sean around. He has so much energy.
Yeah, he put those painted waves here so people can sit in all the cubes, but like, within the ocean.
Yes, he said we'll be sitting among the waves. This is going to be the single best party that has ever existed. So, we're clear about how everything goes, right?
Yes, Mom. Most of the changes were my ideas. I got it.
Oh, and I'll yell the safe word if we stop.
I can't begin to tell you how uncomfortable I am having a safe word with my mom.
Me too, kid. Me too. I currently have a safe word with both my mother and my daughter. But life is funny sometimes. And the safe word is?
Coriander.
Coriander. Are we being jerks if he's sick?
Mom, look, you're sick and you need his help. If he's faking it, you should know about it. And if he's really sick, he won't remember.
Nora Jane.
I know, I'm the worst.
I've been thinking. I know you want to help, but when it comes time, I think I take over the show. I like that plan better.
Mom, I get that you don't want to traumatize me or whatever, but I'm sorry. You wouldn't follow through. For follow through, you've got me or Grandma. And Grandma can't tap dance, so we'll do a thing. I'll get the answer you need.
You kid are...
I know, I'm the best.
Malone enters from the door. He has a crate of stuff for drinks.
Hey, you two.
Hey, Dad.
Excited for the big party, your big show-based business debut?
Dad, calm down. It's just what I've been working on with Sean. Plus, we're going to figure out if...
Hey, hon, do you need a hand with any of that? Setting it up?
No, I've got it. You're going to what, Nora?
What?
You said, plus we're going to figure out if...
Plus we're going to figure out if Brian comes in a costume or not. It's going to be so great!
Steph, you're doing that thing where your voice gets super high. What are you all planning?
Well,
it's a surprise. Nora, run upstairs and grab me,
Mom, you can just say you need to talk to Dad.
Nora, I needed you to grab... Fine. I need to talk to your dad.
Okay. I'm gonna go see what's happening with Sean. Maybe he's done setting things up on the lawn.
Hey, so about all that.
Yeah. What are you and Nora up to?
Alan gets a text notification, then another one.
Do you need to check that?
No, it's fine. Do you want to ask me something?
What I want is to not have to ask you something.
Yeah, because actually engaging with me...
That's not what I'm saying. I have a lot going on right now.
You think?
I'm sorry, is there something you want to say?
Steph, bringing your father into this house, we have so much going on already. And then he moves in here, it was bound to make problems. I don't understand why you took him in.
We took him in.
Come on, Stephanie. I didn't have any say in this. You didn't ask. You told me. And now there's music playing at all hours, like he's sick. And that's hard, but not just for you, but for Nora and for me and your...
I'm sorry if my cancer and my father are too much for you to handle.
Wow. Okay, Stephanie.
I'm trying to set up my mom's party, and my dad is here, and it's a lot, and... Maybe I just wish you'd be where you'd say you'd be, maybe, just maybe, once in a while.
Stephanie, I'm not your father.
I didn't say you were, and that's a low bar to clear, Alan.
Another text notification.
Oh my God, just answer your phone, whoever that is, and maybe we can talk later.
I'm not answering the phone. It's just someone from work, and I'm here now, Stephanie. I'm at the party, and I'm standing in the middle of a... What is this? The Titanic?
It's Anything Goes.
I don't know that one.
It's Cole Porter. You know that song.
I don't.
It's a famous song, Alan.
Oh my God, Stephanie, fine. But I'm here now, setting up the bar for your mom's party, and somehow... I'm not showing up for you.
You were gone all day yesterday. You know what? Can we not do this now, please?
When? When should we do it?
How about when you get 10 minutes without texting someone, whoever you're texting?
Jesus, Stephanie, you make it impossible to have a conversation about anything that's going on.
Okay. I'm sorry. I just need to get through this party. There's a lot to figure out.
Figure what out? Us? Steph, could you let me know what's going on? It's like you have imaginary fights with me all day, but when I'm here, you... Okay. We get through the party, and then we'll talk.
Yes, I promise.
Okay. I'll put my party face on. This is how much fun I'm having.
Lower the wattage. They'll know you're faking.
Text notification.
Answer your phone. Oh. And by the way, and thanks for asking, the tests came back yesterday and no one's a match.
Johnny enters from his room. He is in a suit. He looks nice, cleaned up a bit.
Dad, look at you. You look.
What?
I clean up okay.
You sure do. You look good, Dad.
Thanks, Woog. Sorry. Thanks, Stephanie. Alan.
Hey, John. Looking sharp.
Thank you. Are you both changing? Am I too dressed up?
I do need a change. We should do that, right?
Yeah, we should do that now.
Dad? You have to promise me if Brian gets here, you call me. Okay?
Sure. Okay, Steph.
Okay, we'll be right back down, Dad.
Johnny pulls out his phone. He texts.
Come on.
Deb enters from the front door. She looks nice, put together, but still super casual. She carries a tote bag.
What in the gay hell is going on here?
Deb, you look...
Well, John, I took a shower. What with it being?
Happy birthday. You look great.
Thanks, John. You look good, too.
Thank you. So, Nora's great, huh?
Yeah, John. She's a great kid. She has been her whole life, and you'd know that if you don't.
I know, Deb. I wanted to say that she reminds me of you. And Stephanie, but mostly you.
John, about this party.
Brian enters. He is in the same outfit as Sean. What looks adorable, if over the top on Sean... looks absurd on Brian.
Brian.
Mom, don't.
Brian, you look so...
nautical.
Yes! That's the word I was looking for. Nautical.
Buddy, did he make you do this?
Lay off, okay? It's my luck the first thing you two agree on in 30 years is making fun of me. I'm wearing a sailor suit. It was worn by a young dancer in the production of Anything Goes, who seems to have been named Richie. I put up some resistance to this plan, but ultimately decided that it was more important to show up to my mom's birthday than to stay in a fight with my boyfriend. So, happy birthday. Where should I put my gift?
Thank you, honey. All I want are several pictures with you tonight while you're wearing that. That would be more than enough for me. But thank you for the flowers.
Flowers are not for me. I just picked them up for him.
Brian grabs them and hands them to Johnny.
Happy birthday, Deb.
Oh, go to hell, John. They're very pretty. Brian, can you please put them in the fridge so they won't wilt and die by the time I go home?
Yep. Steph, please come spend time with me and our parents.
Steph,
Brian? Is that you? Dad, I told you to tell me when Brian gets here so I could...
Steph?
Oh, Brian.
Steph, we both know there are a lot of things you could say.
Yes.
But I don't know if I can.
Okay. You're right. I can let it go.
Oh my God, fine. You get three right now. That's it.
Okay. Is the toddler you stole that from just walking around naked?
Okay, that's one.
I want to make a joke involving good ship lollipop.
That counts.
Brian, you look fine.
Mom, I look like a gay Muppet.
Yes, but you look fine while doing it. I think they get this humor thing from you.
I guess they do.
Last one, you get one more.
Whoa.
Alan, hello.
Hey, you look...
Yep, your wife is giving me her three best attempts at jokes right now.
Oh, how many did I miss?
Two. Okay, my last one is, Mom, close your ears.
I will not.
Okay, but I warned you.
Oh my God, everyone. Doesn't my cuddle bear look so cute? Did I interrupt something?
No.
Steph was just making some jokes about what Brian's wearing.
That's not what I was...
Why would you do that?
I wasn't making jokes. I was teasing.
Brian said it was stupid. I should have listened.
I didn't say it was stupid. I just said it was a lot.
Sean, these decorations, they are terrific, Sean.
Yeah, Mom's been talking about how great they are.
I have. Sean, how did you come up with this theme?
Well... You and Deb went on a cruise recently. You said Deb went on a cruise recently, and I thought, anything goes.
It was actually a riverboat cruise.
Oh, Mom, come on.
Well, it was.
Really? Hey, why didn't you tell me it was a riverboat cruise? The theater did showboat, too.
I don't know. It didn't seem...
Important? Because the whole idea of making your mom's birthday special was stupid. Because bringing some fun into your life is always a bad idea. Oh, got it. Loud and clear.
Hey, Sean.
Goes to Sean. Sean walks away and moves a set piece or something in an arbitrary way as a way to be distant from Brian.
Nora, your mom was telling me you're doing a performance tonight. How about it?
Oh, I don't know if now is the best time.
Steph, I think now is the absolute best time to change the mood a little bit.
I'd love to see it.
Yeah, Steph, now would be great. Sean has worked really hard with Nora, and I know how great his work always is.
He's only seen me perform once.
And what did I say about it?
He said he couldn't take his eyes off of me.
I couldn't, and I still can't, Sean.
Brian goes to Sean. They kiss.
Okay, let's do it. Nora, are you ready?
Okay, I guess we're doing this. Okay, everyone, take your seats. The show is about to begin. Are we sure we want to do this now? Like, maybe we eat sandwiches first?
Don't be nervous. You'll be great, honey.
Knock 'em dead, sweetie.
Thanks, Grandma. Thanks, Grandpa.
You're welcome.
Honey. Do the show, and if for some reason it's not going well, we can always stop the show.
Right. Okay, right. Sean, get the lights ready. I just need to change my shoes and outfit real quick.
Stephanie, come here.
As Nora changes into her costume and tap shoes, Alan serves drinks to Johnny and Brian. Deb grabs a manila envelope and pulls Steph to the corner.
So what's the big plan?
This is the plan.
Nora's show is the plan?
Yes, Mom.
Okay, we'll see how that goes. Anyhow, Stephanie, I think you should look at this.
Ed pulls out the items in the manila envelope.
It's from that box in your father's storage unit.
Mom, this stuff... Am I being an asshole?
Ryan, can you turn down the house lights?
What?
Just turn off the living room lights, Uncle Brian.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Brian turns off the lights. Everyone gets settled.
And now, if music died and all we were left with were words, a college audition monologue written and conceived by Sean Dennis.
Alan gets a text. He checks it. He responds surreptitiously. Steph is looking at the things from the manila envelope.
Hey, time out. Just wait a couple seconds. I need to talk to my dad about something before we start.
Okay, we're holding.
Steph approaches Johnny, takes him somewhere a touch private.
Everything okay, Steph?
Yeah, it's just, I need to talk to you about Nora's,
You know what, Steph? She thinks she heard something when I was on the phone, and I,
Dad, no, hey, I don't mean...
I was talking to my priest, Stephanie, and I don't know what story Nora made up about it, but you know how teenagers get. I know she's a creative kid, but I think maybe she makes up stuff from time to time, so... Yeah, anything she thinks she heard. I just don't know if you can believe what she's saying.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sure, Dad. Yeah, sure. Thanks for telling me that. Makes everything a lot easier having heard you say that.
Well, I'm glad to hear it.
Are we still holding, or do you want us to do the show?
Oh, I'm completely ready for the show.
Okay, and recording. Do the intro again, Sean.
And now, if music died and all we were left with were words, a college audition monologue written and conceived by Sean Dennis, presenting Nora Jane Hobson.
Sean turns on the stage lights to find Nora in a theatrical pose facing upstage, away from her audience in the living room. Music plays. It stops suddenly. She turns around slowly and dramatically.
Times have changed, and we've often rewound the clocks.
She begins to tap.
And we've often rewound the clocks.
He taps more.
We've rewound.
He taps the same thing backwards.
Rewound.
Slow, easy tapping.
If I rewind to the beginning, I can see that all that matters, all that has ever mattered, is the truth.
The line is, all that has ever mattered is dance.
We're trying something different.
On show day?
Sorry, Sean, we made some small changes. Okay, Nora, go ahead.
All that has ever mattered is the truth. The truth of the truth. And so, in this room, right now, right here, together, we will find the rhythm of the truth. The rhythm. Can you find the rhythm with me? Clap and repeat with me. To tap the truth. To tap the truth. Do it with me. To tap the truth. To tap the truth. Silence. Now I tap out my truth. Now I tap to find the real of the real. The world is round. Vaccines are safe. Science is real. Gender is a social construct. Live in the now. No one else can make you happy. To learn is to grow. Dance is emotion in movement.
Yes.
This room is full of love. I love and I am loved. Love is what matters. Truth is what matters. Hope is what matters. Change is what matters. I am the future. This is my truth. The rat-a-tat-tat of the feet of truth.
Tapping suddenly ends.
And now, may I have a volunteer?
Steph, I love these changes. Brian will volunteer.
Sean, that's okay. Why doesn't Nora choose?
No, it'll be fun. Brian, get up there.
Okay. Ooh, pick me. Pick me.
You, sir, the man in the snug sailor suit.
You are your mother's daughter.
Thank you.
That's not a compliment.
Brian, you don't need to do this. We can have Nora choose who gets picked.
Don't worry, Steph. I can handle to tap the truth.
No, Brian. It's
okay. We can let Uncle Brian start and then we can get another volunteer. Okay?
Come on, Stephanie. This is fun. It's really good so far. It's interesting. Different, but interesting.
Yeah, honey. This is great. Keep going, Nora.
Okay. So my work with Sean was about the power of dance. And he's always saying that theater should affect change. And in my intro to psychology course at school, we learned about the use of distraction as a means of getting people to tell the truth. I am marrying these two studies today, here on this very stage.
This is your college audition piece?
I will ask you a question and you will tell us the truth today, because I will be using the power of tap dance. There will be no room for faking on this stage.
Okay, Nora.
Steph gets up and walks a bit away, looking at the contents of the manila envelope, letters and cards and pictures.
Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
You're doing great.
Thank you. Uncle Brian, your first question is...
Go easy on me.
Of course. Uncle Brian, do you love Sean?
Nora begins tap dancing. In a perfect world, Sean is able to operate a spotlight of some kind. Sean has pointed the spotlight at Brian.
It's very early to know that sort of thing. Please stop dancing, Nora.
My God. You don't love me.
I didn't say that.
But you didn't say you did.
Oh my God, Uncle Brian, I'm sorry. I thought that was an easy question. Mom, help.
Neither of us had said it, but I thought.
You don't love me, Sean.
Mom.
Don't tell me what I feel. Oh God, this is so embarrassing.
Sean, don't you think you'll end up loving someone who's more fun?
But I'm making you more fun.
Oh my God.
Brian means someone your own age who likes dressing up in sailor suits at parties.
Mom, stay out of this.
I'm just telling the truth.
Deb, maybe now...
Oh, do you want to be a parent now? Help your son who's dating babies just like his dad? Is that what you want?
Mom, I'm nothing like Dad.
Because being like me would be the worst thing in the world.
This is not now, Dad.
Steph, you need to do something about all this.
Alan, leave her alone. Why don't you text whoever you're texting all night?
Don't change the subject.
Ryan, I'm sorry this is, you know, falling apart for you, but don't try and put this on me.
Oh, so don't point out that you've been constantly on your phone?
I haven't been constantly.
Yes, you have. Everyone's noticed.
Thank you.
Oh, shut up. We're not on the same side.
Mom, should I stop this?
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Everyone's always shooting me like I'm some terrible husband. I don't know what you'd all like me to do.
Mom! Coriander! Mom! Coriander!
You could put your phone away for 5 minutes while your daughter performs.
Deb, you know what?
I honestly can't believe you'd embarrass me in front of everyone like this. You get in front of your family and you turn into this different person.
Coriander.
Embarrass you? I look like some bargain basement Fleet Week twink, but I'm embarrassing
you. Is that what you think I look like? You match me.
No, Sean, that's the problem. We don't match. I like word puzzles. I like spending time with people who voted in more than one presidential election.
Coriander?
Steph, that's not the right code word.
I'm old enough to have voted in 2 elections.
Well, congratulations.
Coriander! Okay, so this has not gone as planned. I can see now it was not a very good plan, and I need to check in on my plan making during a crisis. But here we are, a family, here we are.
Steph, are you?
I am fine, Alan. I'm going to cut through the shit, if that's okay with everyone.
I wish you would.
Mom. Please, for the love of all things holy, just keep quiet for a few more minutes. Okay. first, I am sorry, Nora. You shouldn't have been involved with this subterfuge.
Wait. This was the thing you were planning? You got Nora involved in this?
Yeah, Dad. We were trying to prove that.
Stephanie, what the hell is going on? What is all this?
All this? All this is a woman at the end of her rope, Alan. What all this is having to make decisions on my own because you're not here. Because you're never here, Alan.
You don't want help making decisions, Steph. You want to do it all on your own.
I just need one man in my life to tell me the truth. Just one. Just one man. Oh, well, not Brian or Sean. I need one straight man to tell me the truth. Nora, go upstairs. You don't need to hear all this.
Yeah, maybe we all should go. I'll just go to my room.
No, Dad, you stay.
I don't think I want to stay. I'll just go to my room.
Mom, Fergie, Nora, go to your room.
Right, Fergie. John, sit down.
Deb, I'm going to my room.
Deb bolts to his door and stands in front of it.
You will sit down and we're going to discuss some things.
Okay, Deb. Okay.
Nora, go to your room. I'm not saying it again.
No.
Nora, listen to your mother.
No. Do you think I'm dumb? I live in this house. You two are mad at each other all the time. And Mom, you're sick. And Dad, you're sad. And if something is about to change for me and you both, I should know about it. And I should know why. I'm staying.
Good girl.
I mean it, Mom. Dad. I'm staying, okay?
Okay.
Okay, honey.
Ryan, I think we should talk about it.
Not now. Can't you see she's about to do a whole thing?
Oh, okay. Yeah, sorry. Go ahead, Steph.
Nora. I don't know if you've learned this yet, but this family, we have a problem with faking. See, your uncle and I, we learned from two very different parents. One was as nice as can be. Full of praise and love when he was where he promised he'd be, but that wasn't very often. And he's always had an excuse for everything, no matter how unbelievable it is. And one parent, well, one always told the truth, no matter what. But she could be a little harsh. And then you get their two kids. One doesn't know how to leave men who are terribly wrong for him, even when they happen to be very good tap dancing teachers. And then you have the other, who can't seem to just deal with anything head on. Never pushes people because she pushes too hard. She's scared she'll lose everything she has. You see, everyone, the whole reason for this show tonight, the whole reason why my husband and I aren't expressly dealing with the fact that he's most likely having some sort of secret affair.
Stephanie, I am not.
I mean, God, the whole reason we haven't even eaten dinner yet was because I didn't know how to do this. Dad.
Yeah.
Dad.
Dad, are you having an affair?
Your mom and I, we're just having a hard time.
Nora runs and sits on the stairs.
Nora, God, I'm sorry, kid.
Nora, there's a lot to talk about, but...
I shouldn't have said that. I didn't think.
No, you didn't.
Well, Alan, you know what I do think. I think if you're sad about it, you should text your friend. Or call. Or go see them for a whole day. I mean, Alan, just say it. Just say that you're having an affair.
I'm not having an affair.
Alan, come on.
Alan.
You're never around.
All signs point to you having an affair.
I'm not having an affair. Nora, Stephanie, everyone, I am not having an affair.
Where are you? Who are you texting?
And yeah, who are you texting? during the show.
I'm texting a friend. My friend and I, who I play video games with.
What?
I've been gaming.
You've been what?
I've been playing video games, Stephanie. And I'm texting a friend who I play the video games with because we talk about our lives. We've become friends. That's all it is. Does anyone want to look at my phone? Anyone want to look at my text?
I mean, I can if you want me to.
What?
I mean, I'll look at your phone. So you can prove you're not cheating.
And this isn't your business.
He asked.
He did, but Steph is my sister, so I'll look at his phone.
What? I'm not giving you my phone.
Why not?
What? Because that's...
Oh my God, Alan, you're lying right now, aren't you?
No, I'm not lying. I'm playing video games. But my friend... It's a woman.
Oh!
She's a woman from school. It's Jean. She's the health teacher, but nothing's happened. She mentioned she was in the video games, so we started playing together. We talk, but that's it. I'm just overwhelmed, and I needed a break. So I started playing video games in the car, you know, just as something to do, to zone out, just to have a break.
A break? From us? With your friend Jean?
No, I mean, yes, but not a break from you.
From the cancer?
From being scared about the cancer. And then your dad moved in and things got harder. Sorry, Johnny, but they did. And I just really leaned into this escape. I just wanted to go somewhere else. And Jean, she's really supportive. And I'm able to talk with her about everything that's going on with your dad. And yes, the cancer. And Jean's having a hard time too. She's got this kid who...
Oh, Jean's been having a hard time. That sounds really tough for Jean. Alan, do you want to be with me? With all of us, me, Nora, the cancer.
And Grandpa.
Yes, Nora, I'm getting to him, Alan. Do you want to be with me?
Of course. I love you, Steph.
Yesterday, when you couldn't get to storage, were you at work? You were at Jean's. God, answer me, Alan.
You better answer her, Alan. Listen to me, I know. Fix this.
You know what, Dad? Thank you, but we're going to let Alan figure himself out, okay, Alan? You take a moment and figure out what you want. Because if you can believe it, I've got bigger fish to fry in this room. How's everyone doing? Anyone need a drink? I'm about to move on.
Sean makes a moment. Try not to make a moment of getting a drink.
You know, actually, I'm feeling really tired.
Oh, me too, Dad. I'm also really tired.
I think I need to lie down.
Fergie.
I don't know what that means.
It means Steph's gonna talk and you're gonna listen. In front of everyone.
Thanks, Mom. Yeah. We're going to talk. Okay, Dad?
Listen,
Okay, Grandpa, just tell the truth.
So, I went to your storage unit.
With all my records.
Yes, with all your records. And I grabbed the box you told me to grab. But with everything going on, I didn't have time to grab it myself, so Mom did. She gave me these.
Steph grabs a bunch of letters and pictures.
What is it? What am I missing? What was in the box?
Well, Sean, it's letters and pictures of us when we were little. And Sean... The letters are letters I wrote to my dad as a kid, which he saved for a very long time.
That's so sweet, Johnny.
Yes, Sean, it is sweet to see my handwriting as a kid, to see pictures of me with my dad And to see that he saved it all, it is very, very sweet. But what else is it, Brian?
Manipulative.
Brian, buddy.
I'm not your buddy, Dad. We talk twice a year.
Dad, I promise this isn't an ambush. Well, it was. The tap dancing was an ambush. I had a couple code words, but no. Now we're just having a family talk. Because we should just all...
Tell the truth.
Yes. So, Brian, why would it be manipulative?
Well, you asked to see his medical records, and he told you to grab that particular box.
And Mom, were there any medical records in there?
No, there were not.
But what was in there were a series of letters I sent. And pictures.
Which would make you have feelings about around the relationship with your dad.
Yes, Sean, exactly. But I'll take it from here. So, let's do this. Dad, I think you purposely sent me to that box so I would look at these things. And I think you did that because you never went to a doctor. And instead of just telling me that, well, you thought you'd make me look at this stuff and I'd be moved and drop the whole thing. Dad, are you sick? Are you really sick? Because there are no medical records of you seeing a doctor, like you said. And also, there's this whole sexy time song you played when Mom was here, and she said that she always led to sexy time.
Steph, please, stop saying sexy time. It's gross.
Dad, are you sick? Or is this just some lie?
This isn't a lie. But there may be parts that are less true.
Oh, God. So you're not sick. And I upended my life, which sent my husband into his car to play video games with Jean from work.
Listen, Stephanie. Listen, everybody. I have not gone to a doctor, but not because I shouldn't have. I forget things. I'm on my own, and I forget things.
But your episode when we play cards yesterday, it was a performance. So I wouldn't keep looking for your records, right? I've got that right, Dad.
I might have pushed a little to get you to stop, but I am having symptoms.
Why should any of us believe you?
Because it's true. I miss appointments and payments. I've stopped being able to recall conversations I just had. I started having emotional outbursts at fast food places because I get disoriented. And keeping my apartment was getting hard for me. And yeah, I owe some money here and there, mostly a lot of money to my ex-girlfriend. So you were right, Deb, money and a woman.
Figures you'd find a way to say I'm right in a way that feels like shit.
My ex-girlfriend, she's been hounding me. That was who I was talking on the phone, Nora. And I thought if I could stay here long enough, my social security checks could go to her and I get the debt settled. And maybe it's not diagnosed, but I am forgetting things all the time. And I thought if I'm heading towards this thing, towards losing my brain, then I want to spend time with my kids. I want to know one of my kids, at least. I want them to know me. And yeah, okay, maybe as not the best dad. But as a person, you know? And Steph, you're taking me in. And it's been a real gift. You know, you've been so good to me. And getting to know Nora, who is so much like you and your mother, seeing you be such a good mom to her, maybe not tonight exactly, but usually, and getting to see you, Deb. And Brian, and even Alan, and this nice dancer too. This week has been great, and I don't want to have to leave.
In the pictures and the letters.
Yeah, I thought if you saw them, you'd let the other stuff go. But I kept them all these years because I never stopped thinking about you.
Dad, these letters, it's sweet that you kept them, but Dad, You never wrote me back. Looking at these things doesn't make me feel loved. It makes me mad.
Well, yeah, I guess that's not too great either. You know, I didn't stick around because I just thought you all were better off without me, you know? And maybe I didn't like being a dad. It was too much. Overwhelming, like Alan said.
Hey, don't bring me into this.
Dad, Alan is a good father.
Thank you.
But even when I wasn't around, I loved hearing about you. And now you're this amazing person, and that's because I stayed away. You didn't want all the mess I brought with me. Better for me to not be around. Better to just be with your mom. So yeah, I understand if you want me to go. It's not like this is the first time you've been disappointed by me. So I get it. I want to stay. But it's up to you.
Johnny, you lied to me?
To you? Oh my God, Sean. You think this is happening to you? You're like the person in this room this least affects. You should go.
What? You want me to leave?
Yes. Good night, Sean.
Really? Wow. You know what? I'm sorry if I don't like being lied to. I guess I'm not as used to it as all of you. In my family, we tell each other the truth. Also, we act like we love each other. We don't make jokes all the time to prove to everyone how smart we are. We don't change the words of a show so we can finally ask people things. And we know how to have fun. Yes, fun. I know people in this family think that it's the worst thing in the world being fun. But being fun is nice. You can't even enjoy a birthday party. Just be nice to each other and do what you say you'll do and show up for holidays. It's family. It doesn't have to be so hard to love. Goodbye, Brian. Goodbye, everyone. Brian, you need to get this stuff back to the theater tomorrow. It's the least thing you could do after this evening. Goodbye. Stephanie, if you could just make sure to Venmo me for mine and Nora's last lesson. Okay. Bye.
Is he coming back again?
Brian unbuttons the top of his sailor pants and exhales.
No.
Brian, are you okay?
Steph? Am I okay? Yeah, I'm fine. I mean, I will be fine. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Look at us. Both doing fine. Steph, maybe ask Dad to the dance.
To the dance?
Brian is steeped in a metaphor, Dad. He just broke up with the cute boy, so we'll let it slide, okay? Okay. Dad, everyone else knows this, but the tests on Mom and Brian's bones marrow came back and they were not a match. So, Dad, I need you to take this test for me. I'd like to say that I brought you into my home for selfless reasons, but I gotta admit I thought this could happen. And maybe it makes me a shitty daughter to take you in with ulterior motives, but you know, apples and trees. And you owe me, Dad. You owe me. You owe Brian, too, and Mom. But they don't need anything concrete from you, and I do. I need this one thing. And you're going to give it to me.
This procedure, it could save your life?
Yes, Dad.
And it's painful? and there could be complications for me.
Are you honestly hesitating right now?
Mom.
The answer is yes, Johnny. The answer is an immediate yes. It's not questions for your daughter about how much it might hurt. It's yes.
Deb, I just wanted to know
how you wanted to know how much it'll cost you. You can't even step up and do this simple thing right.
Just...
What, Brian? I should just let him off the hook? You all just ignore how he is, and what does that get you? Get mad at him. He deserves it.
Deb, listen. I was just asking a simple question because you need this, you need this.
Oh my God, are you really faking some episode right now?
Just be quiet. I'm really tired and you need me to, I just need to go. I need to get out of this. Just let me.
Dad.
Just leave me alone. I was talking about, I can't get my, stop fucking looking at me. I said stop looking at me.
Johnny starts trying to escape the waves. He begins knocking over set pieces.
Oh, God.
Mom, what should we do?
I'm not hurting anyone. I just need a second to.
Alan puts his hand on Johnny's shoulder.
Get your hands off of me!
Johnny pushes Alan, who knocks into another set piece from Anything Goes.
Just leave me the fuck alone!
Alan.
Brian, grab your father.
Brian, do it. Grab Dad.
I just need to be, I can't, I don't know. Leave me alone.
Brian grabs his dad. It's a struggle, but he's insistent. He holds his dad until Johnny relents and starts just quietly sobbing.
John, I need you to breathe. Okay, I need you to breathe. Can you take a breath in? Can you do that? Steph, come here and sit with your father.
Yeah, of course, Dad. You okay? Dad?
Sorry, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry, Woog.
I know you are, Dad. It's okay. You're here, and we're here.
Yeah, we got you, Dad.
I didn't mean to...
Shh. You know what? Why doesn't Brian bring you into your room? You said you were tired, and we didn't listen. So why don't you go into your room and rest?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Brian brings Johnny into his room. At his door, Johnny turns around.
I want to help you, Steph. I want to stay and help.
It's too late for you to help, Dad. Instead, I'm going to take care of you, okay? We're going to fix you up.
I'm sorry, Woog.
I know, Dad. Dad?
Yeah?
Why didn't you show up?
When?
I don't know. Any of the times. Why didn't you just show up?
I don't know. It's hard to remember, but I guess I was choosing to show up somewhere else instead.
Yeah. I guess that makes sense. Lie down, Dad. Rest. Maybe put on some music. I think music might be nice.
Okay, Woog. I'll put some on. Happy birthday, Deb.
Steph? Hey. You okay?
Yeah. I'm fine.
Are you sure?
I don't know if I'm sure about anything, Alan.
What can I do? I want to help.
Well, there is one thing you can do for me.
Yes. Name it.
Could you leave?
Leave? Like, leave?
No. Maybe. I don't know, but for now, just leave the room. I'd like to be with my family right now.
Steph, I'm your family.
You were. Earlier today, you were my family. And you might be tomorrow, but right now, you feel like a problem. And I have so many problems. You asked me how you could help, and this is how. Just go upstairs, please.
Okay. I didn't touch her, Stephanie.
I don't know that I believe you, and honestly, I don't even know if I care.
Okay. Well.
Nora, Steph, and Deb are left on stage as music begins to softly play in Johnny's room. Steph sits down on a cube among the scattered waves.
Mom, I'm gonna go check on Dad.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Hey, Dad. Dad, I'm coming up.
Well. Shit!
I just felt like I knew your dad was faking.
Me too, Mom. I really needed him to be faking, you know? But he goes and tells the truth about this one fucking thing.
I put Dad to bed.
Brian, I wanted this to work so bad.
Oh no.
God, what am I gonna do?
You'll get on the wait list, and you'll get a match and a donor, and this will all work out.
Mom, that's not...
That is what's going to happen, Stephanie.
Okay, Mom. Okay. That is what's going to happen.
Hey, Steph.
Yeah?
What was your third joke?
What?
The third joke about my costume. What was it?
The third joke was, I'd sing you're the top, but in that outfit, it's hard to believe you are.
You're a fiend.
Ryan, please, I have cancer.
Mom?
Yeah? Is your dad okay?
Yeah. He's fine, Mom. Mom, we were talking and ask me, Mom.
Nora, we've talked about this and I'm not putting you through that.
Mom, I love you and you're my mom and I will listen to you, but maybe you could shut up and just let me help you.
Listen to the kid, Steph.
But if this doesn't work, Nora, look what happened when I let you help me earlier. It was a mess.
And I'm fine. No permanent damage. Mom, ask.
Nora? Will you take me to the dance?
Yes, Mom. I will. Thank you for asking.
Nora and Steph dance among the waves to the music from Johnny's room. Brian and his mom dance. It's louder. On comes the heels. Watch it. It's big.
Stay away from my window. Stay away from my back door too. Telephone line. Relax, baby, and draw that blind. Kick off your shoes and sit right down. Loosen up that pretty French gown. Let me pour you a good long drink. Oh, baby, don't you hesitate, 'cause tonight's the night. It's gonna be alright, 'cause I love you, baby. Ain't nobody gonna stop us now. Come on. Thank you.
stop us now. Inhibitions run wild. The secret is about to unfold. Upstairs before the night's too old. Tonight, tonight, it's gonna be alright. 'Cause I love you, girl.
Va dire maman. Mon amour, viens plus près, embrasse-moi. Oh, je t'adore beaucoup. Cette nuit est de la nuit. Oh, oui, cette nuit est de la nuit. Oh, je t'aime, je t'aime, je t'aime. Cette nuit, oh.
You're the top. You're the Louvre Museum. You're a melody from a symphony by Strauss. You're a Vendel bonnet, a Shakespeare sonnet. You're Mickey Mouse. You're the Nile. You're the Tower of Pisa. You're the smile on the Mona Lisa. I'm a worthless chick, a total wreck, a flop, but a baby on the bottom, you're the top. At words poetic, I'm so pathetic that I always have found it best, instead of getting them off my chest, to let them rest unexpressed. I hate parading my serenading, as I'll probably miss a bar. But if this ditty is not so pretty, at least it'll tell you how great you are. You're the top. You're Napoleon Brandy. You're the nose on the great Durante. You're the nimble tread of the feet of Fred Astaire. You're an O'Neill drama. You're Whistler's mama. You're Camembert. You're sublime. You're a turkey dinner. You're the time of the Derby winner. I'm a toy balloon that's fated soon to pop. But a baby on the bottom. Yes, a baby on the bottom. But a baby on the bottom. You're the time.
Welcome back, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you, Stephen. Thanks for staying around for those of you who are staying for feedback. And what a great way to start the festival. So with us again are Martine Key Green Rogers, Laura Jacqmin, and Tammy Winters. Their bios are available on the website. Stephen Strafford is here, the playwright. Yay! So I'm just gonna let you all jump in, Tammy, Martine, and Laura.
Fabulous. who wants to get started? Like, oh, Laura, you're muted.
Are you guys hearing doubled audio? Sorry, I'm...
No.
I'm gonna log out and come back in because I'm hearing Mary's intro. I'll be back.
Sounds good. Ah, the fun time with the Zoom Zooms.
You may have still had YouTube open.
Yeah,
YouTube my bad. Delay.
I'll text her.
Well, one of the things that I just have to say is that I love me a family drama because there is no kind of drama like the kind of drama you find in a family. So like, first and foremost, I just wanted to say that thank you for this family drama. Thank you for putting the drama in family drama. and also, you know, in that sort of same vein, one of the things that's so interesting to me about your play is sort of the dynamic characters that we're finding in this family. For example, I just love the fact that I don't even know how to say this without, I don't know if I have the right words, but I feel like everyone's a little sticky. Everyone's a little dirty. Everyone's like, you know, no one is clean. and I really appreciate that because I think sometimes the instinct is to wanna clean people up. But let's just be honest, no one's perfect and every family's dirty. So like, let's go ahead. So I just wanted to start there. I know that Tamara looked like she had something that she wanted to say. So I don't want to take a chance.
I always have something to say. So never wait on me. but I completely back you up. Yeah, I think there is something in this family that is very deeply relatable because I think no matter what family we're brought up. I always shy away from saying anything's universal because nothing's really universal, but I think there is a familiarity in discovering how messy your mess of a family really is that is certainly resonant. So yeah, absolutely. I also personally, the core conflict of this play is so juicy. Anytime you have, you know, it's so delicious as a director to see a show that has a really juicy like core conflict where the conflict itself is people who want similar things, but in order to get them, those things clash into each other. And so the reveal that he's lying, but also not lying, and also really does need a home and really was trying for once to tell the truth, even in his own selfish way, just amplifies the juiciness of Steph's struggle. And I'm always a fan of like lean into, I love a play where, you know, I always come back to, you know, the Glass Menagerie. It's cliche, but it's true. When it's done well, it's never about the mom being a monster. It's always about the mom truly wanting what she thinks is best and also that never being what's actually best. And I think this play, I think I encourage, you know, I'm curious as to what your plans for, like, do you have plans for further revision and rewrite? Does this feel like further along in its journey to you, or are you looking for refinements? Because that, you know, that's gonna color, I suppose, our feedback on it. But if there are tweaks and rewrites in your future, I always encourage the more you can tease out his motivations without showing your hand, you know, I mean, and that's the trick, you know, we don't want to show your hand too early, but the more we strengthen the sense of him for once trying to do what's right, and that being the thing that makes what Steph needs impossible, that's awesome.
I wrote down so many lines. I just thought that your humor was so great. Like the jokes are just so great. And I know it's the one big issue with Zoom readings, right? Is that you can't hear the audience feedback, and the chat was going off.
The chat was delightful.
I feel like you were able to track some of it through there, but just, you know, like DJ Dementia and your home has a smell and is he dumb? He really misuses words and just like all this stuff. I was writing down so many jokes, and I think it makes everyone so likable and dynamic and interesting, and also like a little mean, so much so that when it's Sean who's the boyfriend. Yes, when Sean at the end is like, my family enjoys being nice and they enjoy telling the truth, and I've been in comedy rooms before where I'm like, you guys are just jerks, man, like cool it off. And so I appreciated his perspective that he was like, no, kindness is good. You don't always have to be smart and mean and funny. Mm-hmm. And take a look at yourselves. And I really appreciated that too. So yeah, I think it was the very first thing I noticed, and something that I tracked throughout was just like the humor was great.
Yeah. Just to piggyback on that, I wrote down, thank you for the himbo redemption.
And then,
because he's the butt of the joke for so much of the play, but he is right. We could just be people to each other, and that it does dramaturgically a really cool thing where it really reveals one of the key themes that I was tracking throughout the play is, you know, what does honesty actually look like? And what does it actually mean to show up for someone? And they do everything in their power not to attack things directly in this play until that moment. And so giving Sean an actual, like, a redemptive action that then forces the hand of everyone else is great. I mean, that's awesome.
Yeah, and just sort of to piggyback on that too, my favorite part was this whole conversation about him being in Dora the Explorer and how Dora, and like what I totally caught so much was that whole reveal. Like he's talking about how they're changing lives, and I was like, Dora the Explorer, but in some ways he is Dora the Explorer and he's changing lives. So I was like, oh, I love it. And then as the rhetorician in me, who never has the right word for anything, just adored the fact that he was the king of malapropisms. and I wrote so many. So one of my favorite things to do is a sad trombone noise. And so when I'm taking notes on things, I'll be like, womp, womp, and then this thing. And I have so many of them. I was like, you know, womp, womps. There's so many womp womp moments in this play, and I actually don't even know what my handwriting says right there. Like I don't even know what my handwriting says. So I was apparently so excited about it I couldn't write legibly, and then just these amazing moments. And I think also the juxtaposition of these womp womp moments with just honest to goodness truth. Like one of my favorite lines, which is such a simple line, but I feel like it's such a true line, which is, I don't think the universe works like this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, yeah, that's real. So, I mean, I think, you know, generally I'm just gonna spend a lot of time gushing about the character dynamics. This is such, I mean, even though there is, you know, a plot, this is such a character play as well. We have some very distinct personalities coming through, and you know, and although there is a amazingly sort of great and sweet and sentimental end to it, I was tracking those personalities because it was just inevitable that something was about to go down in this family. And so, you know, in some respects, I was thinking a little bit about what Tamara said, because, and I don't know, I'm going to own as a dramaturg that reads way too much over the course of a year. There was a small part of me that was starting to really say, okay, is there a way where this play is going to subvert my expectations about how it was going to end? And I have to admit, the one place where I think maybe the hand got tipped a little too early was about the father, because what I really wanted was to like worry for longer about whether or not I thought he was actually sick. And I don't know exactly when it was, but it was before the reveal that he actually was having some problems that I was like, yeah, he's not okay. And so then it was about like confirmation theory.
Yeah, I think there's a course correction that's in this script from when it came to Out of the Blue.
Okay, got it. Gotcha. Got it. Yeah, because I was just like, yeah, now I know he's not okay. So I'm looking for the confirmation theory that he's not okay, as opposed to really being surprised that he was. So yeah. But I mean,
I wonder if that, you know, and this is the director in me, but I wonder if there's an opportunity in that moment, right at towards the top when he's playing cards with Steph and he has the episode, but perhaps there's more of an opportunity for that to feel more performative. And that might be more a director thing than a playwright thing. I'm not sure, but to leave that more mystic, give her more reason to think, is he putting me on, as opposed to, oh God, maybe he's actually sick. I don't know.
It's so interesting. You know, that was something I was tracking, was the dad of it all and dad's behavior. And one of the lines that I wrote down that I really loved was actually your act one out, which is, you know, Alan sort of surreptitiously texting and the dad saying, you know, if you break my daughter's heart, like, I'm going to fucking kill you. Mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, it's a great way to end it. It's a great way to send people to intermission. You know, I will say I felt like the dementia was a bit nebulous. I think that, you know, I think of like an incident my father had when he was younger and he rented a room from some nice old lady in Boston. And the sign that he knew he had to call her kids was she was heating a can of soup, a sealed can of soup in a pot on the stove, and it set off the fire alarm. So I'm wondering, like, what was the precipitating incident that either made him realize, or that's the story he's telling, or that's something the neighbor said or the landlord said. Again, it's taking me right back to my OU training days, right? But it's where is the conflicting evidence? What is the evidence that dad is sick? And I think for dementia especially, I think instead of smoothing out edges, I think it actually tends to make a person the most concentrated version of who they are, positive and negative, sometimes especially negative. And so when you introduce this fascinating like con man character to me, I'm like, ooh, like they call him, I think this is the mom who's saying he's a scammer, he's a user, he's a liar. I'm like, ooh, I wanna see that. I wanna know that dad. I wanna get to know that guy. And sort of what is the experience of the daughter? And then of course the granddaughter who he doesn't know, what is the experience of having that scammer, that user, that liar in the house? And you know, you've got a very concentrated period of time here, right? It's not a play that takes place over a long period of time. So you kind of have a limited time span to work with. But those were the things that I was sort of looking for. Everyone else has such handles to grab onto, right? Moments where you love them, moments where you're like, ooh, you're maybe not responding in a healthy way to this situation, or you have some behaviors pre-wired in that are great for drama, not so great for, you know, mental health or personal well-being. He felt, I think, a little bit sanded down. And I think in terms of, okay, forgetful, we understand that with Alzheimer's, but what else can we see with this guy? Especially because you've landed him, the end of the play lands him in such an interesting middle ground, which is it's onset, but it's not super bad yet. But there's enough super bad to let us know that it's sort of real. And I think that could be sort of brought out a little bit.
So one of the things that I'm thinking about, and some of this I'm just sort of drawing upon on some unfortunate like personal experience with my mother-in-law who has dementia. But I'm thinking about one of the things that's always fascinating to me about some of the behaviors that were very clear to me right away that something was not quite right. And for me, it was always that weird thing where it was something rooted in an actual task, but something about it was being done kind of oddly. Case in point, I'm thinking about the one time where she was putting away dishes, which is totally benign act, but she had also poured herself some coffee. And she'd forgotten that she had poured herself some coffee. So as she's putting away the dishes, she accidentally put away the dish, like the mug that had coffee in it. And part of me wonders if maybe there's something about this box that could something like there could be the feeling of the subterfuge, but then there's also something hidden in that box as well that also has a bit of a something happening in it that also was like, okay, I'm still confused, like for the character, still confused. Is he manipulating or is he this? Like, I'm not sure because both of these things may live in this box at the same time.
On that level, I did like the records versus records aspect, because, and I feel like that suggested that to me, and maybe that's a thing that could perhaps be strengthened, and maybe I just took that leap, but I do love the idea of like, yeah, I check my records, and they get there and be like, does he think that albums are the same as records now? Like, are that the same as medical records? Is like, is he confused or is he doing a thing?
But I am just so deeply in love with just all of the amazing things that this family does to both show their love and also show their utter dysfunction simultaneously. Like the fact that he was wearing that outfit and should not have had that thing on was just, I feel like those are the things that you do for partners that you know you have no business doing, but you're gonna do it anyway because that's what they want, and you're like, you know what, I'm not gonna fight you on this because there are other battles to be fought. And I just find that so endearing. So I'm skipping all over the place, so just know that. But
I also love the theater stuff, and it's so tricky, right? Because it can come across as inside baseball, and it never did, which is like, I've read plays recently that are playing around with theater stuff, and it's cute, and I'm always like, it's a little too niche, right? And this was not. I loved it just felt so seamless that she was getting ready for her college auditions. I know so many acting coaches now, this is the mainstay of their, you know, how they make their money. So that felt super real. I liked that she was changed. I liked that it was a Hamlet to catch the king, you know what I mean? Like, I did not expect it at all. And so when that suddenly became sort of like the structure of act two, I found it really delightful. And again, I think in a staging, when you have all that stuff there, because you have this grounded but very funny family drama, right, about secrets coming out, and then it's amped up by sort of like the daughter pointedly creating drama and stuff, I just thought the stew of it really worked, was really fun, and none of it felt too, were theater people making jokes about theater.
I totally back you up on that. Also, on top of that, I thought the out of intermission into act two with having Sean like set the scene of the party was so completely delightful and was like a wonderful tonal shift. I suppose in production, there's sort of a trap potentially of the tone shift being so big between act one and act two by that thing. So it's just a thing. I don't think it's a rewrite, but I think it's a thing to be conscious of in production of how do we make sure it's not two separate plays, that it doesn't feel like two different worlds. So is there something in the tone of act one that allows that huge shift to feel like it's in the same world while still being so delightfully like, what the fuck? I love a good WTF moment very, very much. And I love a breaking the fourth wall moment. So the idea of like Sean going in, like adjusting the lights, like you've struck gold with me. But just knowing as a director, that's a thing I would be looking for, to like how to make these live in a world where those two things make sense. So it doesn't feel like it's suddenly a Rashomon, like act one is completely different than act two. It's like a different perspective. It's not, it's the same world. But I loved that shift. It made me like, that's a lean in moment for me, not to use that term, but it did make me lean forward in my seat and go, ooh, okay. All right. That's the play we're in. All right. I want to see more of that play.
Is it possible for me to maybe sort of slightly change lanes on the conversation we're having? Cause I have questions I want to ask. So Stephen, tell me, like, sort of getting back to Tamara's question earlier, but then also getting you to like push that forward a little bit. So tell me, what are you thinking is the future for this play and for you, as a matter of fact? Like what's happening with the play and with you? Tell me things.
Okay. So, I mean, with the play, I'm eminently practical. And if, if a theater was like, we'd love to do this, but we need it to be this and this and this, I'm always drop the ego and I'm like, cool, let's make that happen. But I think the biggest thing is with the play is I want to make sure that I'm not, what I'm hearing this read is that I was so intent on making sure that everyone is informed about what is going on and what Stephanie's doing. I just think it's like a touch too much. And I think there's a few places where that could be taken out. This draft got a lot of jokes, if you can believe it. I want all the jokes to have jokes after the jokes. But I was trying very hard to let jokes land and not be commented on. Mm-hmm. That was like a goal for this draft. For me, my little journey, I was an actor. I am an actor. I mean, sometimes I'm an actor. And the first thing I wrote was a solo show. That was, I talked about it earlier at the Fringe Festival. And that was a comic musical solo show that had actual video footage of my mom about my meth addiction. So, you know, standard. And after that, I wrote, because people kept asking me, what are you writing now? And I am easily socially pressured. I started writing a play and then it got produced. It won this contest and it got produced in Houston and then it got produced in Chicago and then in Sioux City. And I started to realize that I have all of these stories built up from like years of, like I think everyone's funny. Everyone I meet, I think is hilarious. I think they're hilarious, not in a mean way. Sometimes it's in a mean way, but often it's not. And so I think comedically, like I think like, I find so much absurd and there's so much trauma and sadness that easily could be like the way I would see the world. But instead I got lucky, I think, and see it as like, I don't know, humorous. And so I'm interested in, and my last play, Small Jokes About Monsters, dealt with like trauma. But it was a drama about funny people. And then about when humor becomes ugly. That's like this last play. And so, and then there's like a play in between that play and this play, which is about the intersection of racism, homophobia, capitalism, and Chicago. And that's the play that's like actually out in the world right now, like doing the contests and all those things. And then this play came from my dad, because in my last play, the dad character was dead. And my dad, who lives in Kazakhstan, but we don't have time for that story. He said like, I've got this idea for a play. What about an estranged father? And I was like, uh-huh. He's like, an estranged father has dementia and he moves in with his kids. I was like, Dad, there's a lot of plays like that. Like, no, he's faking. Mm-hmm. And that was like the impetus. But then I didn't really want to write the play from that point of view. And I'm really, really interested in writing complicated women and complicated gay characters, because I did not get to audition for those. So I am trying to write the roles that I wished I could have played, you know? So yeah, I'm still fairly new to writing. And I feel like I have too many stories to write down in time.
That's a good feeling. I think your instincts are spot on for where this play is in its draft, in its life. I don't know if that means there's a full another rewrite draft in it or if it's just some minor surgery, but I feel your instinct that like now we know so much of Steph's motivations that I could do with more mystery on her end. I sort of feel like I clocked where she was coming from the beginning, and I like her, and so I don't mind that, but I think dramatically I could use more mystery on what her needs are and what her what her journey is, so that it's more of a payoff when she finally relents and allows her daughter to step up for her. I think her inner conflict is so wrapped up in with this idea of like wanting so much for someone to step up for her in the way that she wanted when she was young, and not being open to people stepping up for her in new ways that she's not comfortable with. And that, you know, so I think that there is more mystery we could get from her on how she gets from point A to point B.
Something so interesting about, you know, women being the ones who take on the burden of emotional labor. And so the fact that dad comes to the daughter, right? Dad doesn't come to the son, dad comes to the daughter. In a way, because he knows that she's a mark, which is super interesting, right? Yeah. So that, first of all, and one of the other things I loved was that both siblings have clearly been poorly wired in terms of trust. And you see how that comes from the dad, you see how that comes from the mom, that they're in these functional relationships, they love their families, but also you see where some things went wrong, and you see where, you know, what Sean calls, you know, some of the meanness, you see where that comes from. I honestly really just had one note, and it sounds like a big note. I actually think it's a very surgical note. And you said, you know, knowing about Steph's motivations and all that, that we know a little too much. I think it would be helpful to look at who knows what when and what their point of view on it is. It was very clarifying in the storage unit when her brother said, the reason you're letting him live here is to harvest his bone marrow. And I was like, there's a version of this play where that is explicit from scene one, right? Because in a way, she has these two warring instincts. One of which is, my dad treated me like shit and he owes me this. The other is, my dad owes me something and I love him. And I want to get close to him in a way that I could never get close to him. But her goal, which is to get dad's bone marrow, requires that he be faking it. So I think where I was getting a little bit lost, and I think this is something that I think if you could just like put it on note cards or put it on post-it notes or something, it felt like she was advocating for both points of view constantly throughout the play, where she's simultaneously saying he's faking it and I want his bone marrow. And she's also telling her mom, he's not faking it. It's real, it's real, it's real. And I think just look at the shifts in the play, who believes what when, and what makes them shift their point of view. Yeah. And I think that's gonna be a super clarifying thing. Cause again, I think it's like the relationships you've got, so much of it you've got, the story you've got, the revelations you've got. I think to me, I'm just kind of like, who wants what when? And mostly Steph, what does she want? What does she expect? Where is the rug pulled out from under her? And where does she shift her thinking? And in a way, like, again, purely take it or leave it, feel free to leave it. In a way, in the second act, I was like, does she even need cancer? If the play is about, am I gonna accept my dad coming back to live with me? And is he faking it or not faking it? In the first act, I was like, oh no, she definitely has cancer. And her very first instinct is, screw that guy, I want the bone marrow. And then it sort of shifts. I'm not advocating that you change your, I'm not advocating that. But in a way I was kind of like, these are sort of conflicting wants and desires around the same thing. And how does it all make sense? And I absolutely think you brought it home with the daughter sort of stepping forward. But there were many times where I was like, ooh, she wants both things at the same time. And it got a little bit hard to track. It's honestly my only note. That's my only note, is really just tracking that information and what people think about it and what each member of the family wants.
May I ask a clarifying question? So that is something I am after, the sort of the being like, I want this, but actually I also want this. And then sort of getting disappointed on both fronts. Mm. Now, do you think it is cleaner, more trackable, if it's clear in, I think what you're saying, I think this is what I'm hearing, right? that like, if it's like, I want this thing happens. Oh, shit, I think maybe I want this thing. Oh shit, this, and it's going back. And then maybe by act two, if we've seen enough turns, we can live in the both because we've seen where it's turned.
100%. I think for me, it's so much about what are the story events that sort of push. So for instance, if the character starts by saying, I want, screw him, I want his bone marrow, I think he's faking. And then he has an episode playing cards and she's like, oh God, this feels really dicey and maybe he's not faking and I love my dad. If it's driven by turns in story, then I'm with you 100% of the way. And she can flip flop all the way through the play because I think that's a natural human response. I think it was in the not motivated on story, just based on, oh, she's talking to one character and saying one thing and talking to another character and saying a different thing. And just really clarifying, yeah, where is her POV flopping? And where it's totally fine for her to be torn and be like, is it bad to want my dad to be suffering? I don't want him to suffer. I want him to be faking it. You know, you see what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Before we split, because I saw we got the 5-minute warning, but I feel like we would be remiss if I did not call out that Deb is a dope character. I love Deb. She's amazing. I want to get drinks with her.
every play, I have another play that I call my redheaded stepchild play that's loosely based on if Ramona Quimby was 38.
I also want to read that play right now.
But that play didn't get produced. And I honestly think because there was a character not based on my mom. And Deb is like a real just recreation of the amazing person my mother is. Like just, my mom takes up space in a room and tells you the truth.
Please tell your mom we appreciate her.
Yeah. She's top of the line.
And your congratulations to your entire cast, your director. Right. I mean, really, really skilled work. Everyone did a phenomenal job.
Yeah.
As a OU acting alum myself, my hat is off to all of you. I love OU fellow actors. You're all amazing.
Yeah. I feel really lucky.
Yeah. And Stephen, I'm going to say the thing that is the obvious thing to say, but it's also the thing that always needs to be said. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us. It is always such an amazingly brilliant and also terrifying thing to do, to share the baby with everyone and show that baby for the first time and hope no one thinks it's ugly. So I appreciate your bravery in terms of like just sharing the story and going all out and bringing that humor in. So thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate your time and your comments. It gives me a lot to think about. I really appreciate it.
And I know this time was brief, so feel free if you want to follow. I mean, you know, I'm volunteering my fellow guest artist's time. If you have any follow-ups, please, you know, don't hesitate. Never hesitate.
Yeah, agreed.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all so much. And I do want to thank the cast, Sarah Saho, Brennan Gallagher, Courtney Abbott, DeVanté Malone, Hannah Woodside, KeShawn Mellon, Ian Kenyon, and our wonderful, fabulous director, Evie Smith.
I love that DeVanté was in a car.
Yes. Gotta go to the next gig.
That style. I like that. Exactly.
Thank you, everybody. We will be back at 4:30 with Starfish. Sorry, it's not in front of me. The name. I'm a starfish. Oh, Wendy Marie, I am so sorry. Why do I not have it right in front of me? But we will be back at 4:30. Awesome.
To be a starfish.
Yay. To be a starfish. Thank you, Martine. Thank God the mentors know.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.